In a rivalry, there are no blurred lines or mixed emotions. Loyalties are clearly defined. In a rivalry, there are no blurred lines or mixed emotions. Loyalties are clearly defined. In a rivalry, you know if a stranger is friend or foe, not by religion, color, or creed, but by the bill of their cap or the letters on their shirt. In a rivalry, colors don't bleed. Battle cries and ritual are sacred. You don't want to lose in a rivalry because then you would lose to them. Welcome to ESPNU College Football presented by McDonald's. A happy Thanksgiving. Thank you for joining us here in the Turkey Day Classic. Tuskegee and Alabama State coming your way from the Cramton Bowl in Montgomery, Alabama. It's the oldest rivalry in black college football. Alongside former NFL quarterback Jay Walker, I'm Anish Shroff. And Jay, you have seen and played in some rivalries in black college football. You've seen the Bayou Classic, the Magic City Classic, the Florida Classic. You played in the battle for the real HU. What makes the Turkey Day Classic special?
It's the battle for the only HU, but this is what a rivalry is all about. When you get an opportunity to take a shot at your opponent, the person all season long you've been gearing up to play, when you go to that school, you say, I can't wait to take on that team in that game. And this game right here is so special because not only are the schools so closely located, but this serves as the homecoming for Alabama State. That's an insult when you play a team on homecoming.
And Tuskegee, they've spoiled homecoming a few times for Alabama State. Tuskegee has won 12 of the last 15 matchups. But this season, Tuskegee's just 4-5. They've struggled to throw the football. So that means if they're going to be successful offensively, it's going to be the ground game.
You know, when you talk about a Tuskegee offense, that normally means the belly G is coming. Coach Willie Slater really likes to pound that football, and this year he's using DeMario Pippen, the transfer from Jackson State University, who's averaging 4.8 yards per carry, to carry the weight load on his offense to eat up the ground game, eat up the clock, and try to come up with some big plays.
Meanwhile, Alabama State, they have a head coach who was a pretty good wide receiver at ASU, Reggie Barlow. Well, Barlow's got a kid now who's basically broken all of his records in Nick Andrews.
And Nick Andrews is a special talent. He averages over 100 yards receiving per contest, one of the best wide receivers at this level of college football. He really can stretch the defense. He's impossible to guard in one-on-one situations. Look for him to end his career here at the Cramton Bowl, trying to go out in style to cap off what's been a remarkable career.
Alabama State has won the toss. They will receive. Willie Slater, the head coach for Tuskegee, 51-7 in his first five seasons as head coach, just 4-5 this year. And there is the aforementioned Reggie Barlow. His team was in the SWAC championship a year ago, just missed out this season. Alabama State will receive. Tuskegee ready to kick off. And the Turkey Day Classic is underway. Kewan Riley across the 25, across the 30. Riley down at the 44-yard line, and it'll be Alabama State with terrific starting field position. And the quarterback for this Hornet team, the junior transfer from Troy, Greg Jenkins. Jay, you've had a couple of opportunities to watch him earlier this season, but he's been banged up. The coaches tell us now he's 100%. We're going to get to see the player that they've talked about and that they've hyped up being such a terrific player.
And more than his athleticism, it's his ability to run the fast-paced, up-tempo offense. He's got a good grasp of it. The key for them is all about pace and tempo.
Tim Clark on first down, and he's met right at the line of scrimmage, no gain. Impact player for the Hornets. Well, it is the senior, Nick Andrews. Good chance to be an FCS All-American this year.
Averaging over 14.5 yards per catch. And the really thing I really like about him, the separation. He's an easy target to throw to because he separates from opposing defensive backs.
Jenkins throws. There's Andrews. And he gets to the 49-yard line, tackled by a Dontavius Turner. Isaiah Person, When we talked to head coach Willie Slater, he said this is the plugger. He's the glue to this Tuskegee defense.
Yeah, he plays the middle linebacker position for the Golden Tigers, and they funnel everything into him because he just doesn't miss tackles, leading tackler on the football team.
Landon Jones, the catch, trying to stretch for the first down. The ball is loose, and Tuskegee says they have it. It'll be Tuskegee football, a turnover on the third play from scrimmage.
You see Landon Jones trying to get those extra yards after catch. We saw Andrews spin. You never see good things happen to wide receivers when they turn their backs to the defense. Good job by linebacker Allen Singleton of forcing the fumble, giving Tuskegee a huge break here in the opening part of this football game.
And Justin Nard, the Nard Dog, he's the quarterback for Tuskegee. A true freshman, but Willie Slater saying he's their best option.
36% completion percentage. He's got to get that up above 50% today for them to have any chance of victory.
That's DeMario Pippen on first down, and he just got back to the line of scrimmage. And DeMario Pippen is the impact player offensively for Tuskegee, a team that really struggles offensively.
And what they're going to try and do is run him with that bounce belly G play. We'll talk about that over and over today. When they pull the guards and tackles, he's quite a load to bring down. Low center of gravity, good runner in between tackles.
And Keewon Riley, there may not be a better defensive back in the FCS.
8 interceptions this season, 7 interceptions a season ago. He's the best center fielder I've seen in FCS football.
Nigel Carr blitzing, and he wraps up Nard after no gain. That was number 12. You saw him coming from that corner, and he was unchecked.
Now watch what Nigel Carr does. He's going to take out 2 runners. He sees them both. He gives them a stutter step move and forces the quarterback to hold onto that ball split second longer. He actually tackled 2 bar carriers on one play.
What Alabama State wants is for Tuskegee to throw the ball. You mentioned the low completion percentage. As a team, they're completing less than 41% of their passes. Nard will throw. It's a little bubble screen. That's Pippen. He gets across midfield, bumped out of bounds, well short of the first down. So fourth down coming up for the Golden Tigers.
Conservative play call there by Willie Slater on the Tuskegee offense. I understand you've got a freshman quarterback that's playing in the game, and you don't want to rattle him. It's probably the biggest game he's played in all season long. But I like to say at this point in the season, you're no longer a freshman. You're more like a sophomore. It's time to unleash.
Gene Moody to punt it away. Riley signals for a fair catch, makes it at the 5-yard line, and that's where Alabama State will start on their second drive. The Hornets turned it over the first time. They get the ball back as Tuskegee unable to capitalize. Welcome back to the Cramton Bowl here in Montgomery, Alabama. Scoreless first quarter. Alabama State just picking up 6 yards on their first play. They had the ball at their own 5-yard line after a 43-yard punt by Tuskegee. And no gain there. It'll bring up third down.
After the turnover, Tuskegee missed a tremendous opportunity. When you talk to the Alabama State coaching staff, they said we cannot afford to turn the football over early and allow them to get a lead.
Landon Jones hangs on, and it depends on the spot if he'll get the first down. Kenneth Baker made the tackle. And it is a first down. So Jones atoning for his fumble on the first drive.
And on that play there, you got an opportunity to see the quick release that Greg Jenkins possessed to go along with the up-tempo offense they're running right now.
Jenkins over the middle, completes. And across the 35-yard line, a gain of 19 yards. That's John Andrews, Nick's older brother, with the catch.
He's going to come from the slot and just attack the middle of the field. Once he gets behind the linebackers, perfectly thrown ball in the weak spot of the defense.
This is Jenkins. He'll keep it. Couple of nice moves. And he gets to the 43-yard line, tripped up by William Buford. If you're saying, hey, Alabama State likes to work fast, well, offensive coordinator Fred Kai saying, we're basically Oregon in black and gold. They've got the white, the home uniform on, but Oregon in white and gold.
I don't know if you want to make a living comparing yourself to Oregon. I don't know if there's any other
in terms
team in
the of the speed that which that they operate.
Yes, they try to.
Jenkins going deep, and that time too far. It'll bring up third down. He wanted Andrews again, John Andrews.
And John Andrews, younger, well, the brother of Nick, the older brother of Nick. And thing about it, it's senior day. Andrews is normally not a regular starter for the year, but because it's senior day, last game here in front of the home crowd, kind of a tribute to the Andrews brothers for their credit, what they've done for this program.
Third and four. Jenkins throws, completes. Andrews has a first down at midfield.
Sooner or later, Tuskegee's going to have to come out of the cover three look that they're given. Too much cushion being given to the outside wide receivers. That's the easiest throw and catch you can make in all of college football. Defensive back 10 yards off the wide receiver. Easy completion.
This is Tim Clark. He finds a seam. Clark inside the 40, but a flag back in midfield. George McCullum's the head referee.
Offense, number 70, 10 yards, previous spot, replay, first down.
That's the left tackle, Terren Jones, so that'll back up Alabama State.
You're going to see Terren Jones right here on the top of your screen. He's got that jersey, and that's just a good old-fashioned throwdown. Not a takedown, but a throwdown. Grabbed all that jersey and slung the Tuskegee defensive lineman to the ground.
And another flag before the play.
Replay, first down.
Jenkins throws, completes. T.C. McWilliams on the near sideline. That's a 26-yard gain, and that appears to be a first down.
A great job by Jenkins in the offensive line. Look at the time that he has. He stays in the pocket and delivers a strike to Williams running along that sideline. Nicely thrown play.
Quickly back to the line of scrimmage. Jenkins will keep this himself. Nice stiff arm. Gets to the 30-yard line, and then he's driven back by Kevin Finnessy.
And one thing you notice when you see Greg Jenkins is athleticism, but almost similar to how you talk about Michael Vick in the National Football League. As a quarterback, your body cannot absorb too many blows. He's got to learn, pick up the yardage that's there, then go down. That's why he's been hurt all season long.
Jenkins over the middle, McWilliams, and he's down inside the 10-yard line. A 21-yard pickup, so T.C. McWilliams, two big catches on this drive.
Going to the soft spot of the defense, and you can tell right now, this Hornet offense is clicking on all cylinders right now.
Horizon red zone, you see what Alabama State has done inside the 20. That time Jenkins didn't have much room, and he's hit for a loss. So second down and goal coming up.
And that's one of those hits you really don't want your quarterback to take. QBs getting hit by defensive linemen, not a good thing.
37 drives, 20 touchdowns, 11 field goals. Second in the SWAC, and again, in the red zone, brought to you by Verizon. Clark fumbles it, recovers, but he lost about two on the play. So now third and goal coming from the 12-yard line.
Not a clean exchange. And this is one where Jenkins has to put the ball in the belly. He delivers it chest high instead of putting that ball in the stomach of Tim Clark. Hornets are very fortunate to recover that fumble.
Well, this is your first look at a healthy Greg Jenkins. What have you seen so far?
The athleticism just jumps out at you. Nice arm, nice release. But the ability to make one or two defenders miss is what makes him a special quarterback and a special talent.
Jenkins has time, throws, and nearly intercepted a dangerous throw. Kevin Finnessy broke it up. He wanted McWilliams again. He didn't give himself a lot of room there.
And Finnessy's the cornerback there. didn't fall for the fake where they tried to bait him going inside. Good job of elevating, leaving his feet, locking that ball away at its highest point.
Bobby Wensing on for a field goal attempt. 29-yard kick is good, and Alabama State on the board. Wensing had missed three of his last four kicks. Hits from 29. The Hornets with a 3-0 lead in the Turkey Day Classic.
My sister's new.
Nothing like tailgating on Thanksgiving. ESPNU College Football presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. We're so thankful you can be with us on this Thanksgiving holiday with Jay Walker and Eve Schroff. And certainly it is homecoming. It is senior day here at Alabama State at the Cramton Bowl. You could not have asked for better weather. Not a cloud in the sky. About 65, 70 degrees. Sun-spangled Thursday afternoon. Reggie Barlow would have liked the touchdown on that last drive, but he'll take the early lead. A 14-play, 83-yard drive, capped by a 29-yard field goal by Bobby Wensing. So Alabama State with a 3-0 lead here in the first quarter.
Barlow's got to be happy to have the lead. And, you know, keep in mind that although Alabama State went to the SWAC championship game a season ago, they lost the Turkey Day Classic. So that factor from last year is really sitting heavy on the heart of Reggie Barlow. He's trying to inspire his team not to have a letdown, to apply the pressure.
Wayne Williams tripped up shy of the 20-yard line, so Tuskegee will be inside the 20 to start their second drive. First drive, they went three and out after Alabama State turned it over near midfield.
Look at Justin Ard there, good look at him. Freshman from Evergreen, Alabama. And when you talk to Coach Slater, hey, is this the quarterback of your future? He's a freshman, the numbers aren't there. He said, oh, there's no question about it. He can play. He'll be the quarterback at Tuskegee for years to come. But he's just going through his growing pains right now in his freshman campaign.
And a flag before the play.
There's a timeout on the field. Tuskegee player does not have the required equipment. Timeout, Tuskegee.
So a timeout by Tuskegee. And
the equipment timeout.
Equipment timeout, yeah. We saw the flag come in, wondering what it was. It gives us time, because Alabama State won't give it to us the way they play. Gives us time to get to our Twitter question. What's the best rivalry in college football? Get in on the discussion at ESPNU. Tuskegee, Alabama State is the oldest rivalry in black college football. But certainly this is a week of rivalry, not just in the FCS, but in the FBS, where you have Alabama-Auburn this weekend. Iron Bowl's pretty big in the state of Alabama, considering that those two have won the last two national championships. On the ground here on first down, and to about the 24-yard line, a gain of 5 yards. Nigel Carr made the stop. It was Pippen on the carry.
See, when I think of rivalries, you know what? The first one that comes to my mind, it's not the in-state rivalry most people are used to, but Ohio State-Michigan. I think that's one of those rivalries that kind of personified and carried college football.
Although we talked about this Tuesday on the Experts on ESPNU, does this year feel like the least hyped Ohio State-Michigan game in recent memory?
Oh, no question. No question. Alabama State crowd in the line of scrimmage. 8 men around the football trying to force Tuskegee to pass.
Nard trying to run the option there. Only picks up a yard. DeMarcus Taylor brought him down. So third down coming up.
See, and this is what you call trying to force the tempo. Take a look at all these white jerseys. You've got 8 Alabama State Hornets within 5 yards in the line of scrimmage. When you get that look, you've got to throw the football. They're telling you, we're going to surround the football. They're going to do like Hornets do in packing swarms. But Tuskegee not willing to make the check at the line of scrimmage, running an uphill battle.
Tuskegee's signature play is belly G. When they run it, Jay will explain it to you, but we haven't seen it so far.
We haven't seen it. They'll pull the guard and tackle. It's like their signature play, like USC used to run the sweep right, sweep left.
Nard's pass is too high, and Tuskegee staring at another fourth down as it's their second straight three and out.
Well, they've got to find a way to think out something offensively. And this is not new to Tuskegee. Offensively, they have really struggled all season long. And when you talk to them, they say they just have not had an explosive playmaker step up besides DeMario Pippen.
We asked their head coach, Willie Slater, who their most dynamic offensive player was. He didn't have an answer. Good punt by Moody. Riley signals for a fair catch, makes it at the 32-yard line. Alabama State football, when we come back, 6:04 to play here in the first quarter.
College football.
A 29-yard field goal by Bobby Wenzig of Alabama State, the only scoring in the game. 3-0 here in the Turkey Day Classic. And where I'm from, brought to you by the U.S. Marines. Let's take a look at how we got here on the 88th edition of this rivalry game. It began on Thanksgiving Day, 1924. The game was started by two white businessmen, Cliff Green and Fred Cramton. No small thing given the times, and it is the oldest football classic among historically black colleges and universities. This is Jenkins, throws near side. He completes to Nehemiah Henry, who was across the 40-yard line of the 43 and very close to a first down.
Talk about the rivalry here. I think that took me for a loop when you told me that this was the oldest rivalry amongst all black colleges. I think many people assume it's a Grambling or a Southern or a Jackson State, Alcorn State, but this is the oldest.
That last completion, good for a first down. Jenkins to the air once more, and he's got a man at midfield. Gain of 8 yards on the play. That's Nick Andrews.
One thing they do really well with Nick Andrews, they never line him up in the same spot repeatedly. They like to put him in motion, find him in slot formation as well as the X position.
Tim Clark stopped after no gain by Jeremy Brown.
Right now, this Alabama State Hornet offense is getting the ball snapped. 25 seconds left on the play clock. They're not wasting any time getting to the line of scrimmage.
Henry, close to the 35-yard line, 14 yards, and it's enough for a first down. And Alabama State, especially Greg Jenkins, he looks in sync with his receivers.
Yeah, he's got it going, and that's that tempo that they want. Get him up to the line of scrimmage. And that's unique, because normally when a bigger team is taking on a smaller team, you want to wear them out and beat down on them. This one, they're just trying to check out their cardiovascular skills.
Jenkins will keep it, has some room across the middle, across the 20 in the red zone, and inside the 10-yard line. First and goal finally brought down by Kenneth Baker, but not before a pickup of 36.
We've seen some dual-threat quarterbacks that can really move, but look at the aggressive running style that he has. I mean, he's out there running with a purpose. He literally looks like a running back running the football.
You see Tuskegee just getting to the line, just setting up, and Alabama State ready to call the play.
And it's something that you have to practice and practice over and over again. You think you get it down in practice with the tempo, but then all of a sudden, once you get to game day, you've got to crank it up a couple more notches. And Tuskegee seems to be struggling and wearing down. You start looking at defensive linemen with their hands on their waist, normally the first sign of fatigue.
On second and goal, Jenkins for the end zone, touchdown, Alabama State. It's the senior Nick Andrews, his 10th receiving touchdown of the season. And that was a strike from Greg Jenkins, who is 12 of 14 here in the first quarter. Point after is good, 10-0. Reggie Barlow's Hornets in command early.
We talked about how they like to move Nick Andrews around. One-on-one matchup. Watch the location of this throw by Greg Jenkins. This is the back shoulder fade. So you see Andrews is looking. He knows the ball's going to be underthrown. Small window to get that football into. Andrews did a good job of setting him up. Quick release, turn, back shoulder fade. You don't throw it any better than that.
There's only one spot where he could put it, and Jenkins hit that spot.
You know, defensive backs will tell you that is probably singularly the most difficult pass to defend in all levels of football.
Now, as a quarterback, is that not only, is that also one of the hardest passes to throw?
It is, because if the defensive back guesses on that throw, then they're going to take it the other way for a touchdown. So the key is you want to put in a position where if your wide receiver doesn't catch it, it's going to go out of bounds.
Wayne Williams from his own 8-yard line. Williams stumbling, keeps his balance, and he gets close to the 35-yard line. ESPN News coverage of college football continues Saturday at noon Eastern. James Madison, Eastern Kentucky. First round of the NCAA FCS Championship presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. College football on ESPNU this Saturday. Now, the SWAC champion plays in the SWAC Championship. They don't participate in the FCS playoffs. There was actually a chance Alabama State, it was a slim chance, they weren't going to win the SWAC after they lost their final regular season conference game to Southern, but there was a chance maybe of them getting an at-large bid to the FCS playoffs. That didn't happen.
Well, it didn't happen, and, you know, it's so tough to get in there right now in that position there. In the game, we're going to show James Madison, East Kentucky. Both of those teams barely got in, even with the expansion of 20 teams.
Nard pumps, throws, and right into the hands of Keewon Riley. Riley still in bounds. He's going to turn it upfield. And he's down inside the 40-yard line. It's a 32-yard return, and for Riley, his ninth pick of the season.
You'll see Riley right here in the middle, standing on the logo. What did I say about Rob? He
plays
center field better than anybody. Watch him drop back, read the eyes, get depth. Once the ball leaves the quarterback's hands, he says it's his, and he's also the punt returner for the Hornets. So you know after he makes the interception, he gets plenty of yards. That's his ninth interception on the year. He had 108 yards on interception returns this season.
Something that Alabama State does well is force turnovers. That is their 30th straight game with at least one takeaway. And in that span, they forced 81 turnovers. And right off the turnover, an 11-yard catch by Nick Andrews and a first down. And you can already see some of the Tuskegee players' hands on their hips.
And right now, they just seem slower. I think the game plan for Alabama State was to come in here and allow their athletes to make plays. Nick Andrews making catches, Greg Jenkins. Right now, they're just trying to out-athlete Tuskegee.
Jenkins rolls, pumps, throws. McWilliams the catch, and he's down at the 5-yard line. Another first and goal coming up. Kenneth Baker saved the touchdown.
Good job here by Jenkins with the misdirection. Everything's going to go to the left. He's going to pull it out. You see McWilliams there finding the second level of the defense. Three-level throw. McWilliams there in the second level. Nice play.
Jenkins will keep it himself. And he's close to the end zone, but just shy. Darryl Simmons, the JUCO transfer, with the tackle. Second and goal.
This is probably.
I tell you what, Greg Jenkins looks as advertised. This is the player Fred Kay said we were going to see.
Very athletic quarterback, tremendous.
Is he in? He is in. Jenkins sneaks it in. It has been an impressive first quarter for Alabama State. 16-0. Greg Jenkins, 14 of 16 passing, over 40 yards rushing. By himself, he has more than 200 yards of total offense, and there's still 2:23 left here in the first quarter.
They're going on warp speed right now. Seventh rushing touchdown for the season. And you see right here, this is just a good old-fashioned quarterback sneak with the quarterback that likes to run the football anyway. Tuskegee has a problem right now, and that problem is Alabama State's got some athletes that came to play here on homecoming in Montgomery.
When we talked to the head coach for Tuskegee, Willie Slater, he said his defense has kept his team in most games this season. The problem is the offense has not been able to stay on the field. So you get to the fourth quarter, the defense gets tired. Well, the defense has already been on the field quite a bit. The offense has not been able to move it. And this is an offense that really can't throw the football. 40% completion rate. Well, you're down 17-0. This keeps getting out of hand. You're going to have to throw the football. And that plays right into Alabama State's strength, which is one of the best pass defenses and one of the best secondaries in the FCS.
Yeah, for Coach Slater and Tuskegee, it's been one of those seasons. The folks down there in Tuskegee, Alabama, they got so used to winning football games. Well, every now and then you're going to have those rebuilding seasons in which you've got to go through the process. I mean, they've lost more games than they've lost in a season in quite some time. They're normally contending for championships in the SIAC. This just was not the year. Very young team. They've got freshmen starting on the offensive line at the quarterback position. You're going to take your lumps, but he feels that he's got some playmakers and they will be a good team for years to come. But this season just has not gone the way for Tuskegee.
Narn pitches it to Pippen. And Pippen brought down at the 33-yard line. Great pursuit that time by Alabama State and King J. Cotton.
Now, at this point in the game, you know, as you mentioned earlier, you don't want the game to get away from if you're Tuskegee, but it's not panic mode yet. If you can go down and get together a nice drive to put some points on the board to slow down this momentum, and I think the game plan has to change. They've really got to emphasize eating up the clock, because if you're snapping the ball with 20 seconds left to go, you can't get to a gunfight against this Hornet offense.
Hornets were showing blitz and a flag before the play.
Ball start, 69, offense, 5 yards, replay, second down.
That's Charlie Craig, the right tackle, so it backs up Tuskegee even further, 5 yards back, and you're Alabama State, you know they struggle to throw the ball. Do you come with pressure?
I think you just sit back and you just crowd the line of scrimmage to make sure they don't run the football. I would not be surprised to see Tuskegee come out and try and run the football just to eat up some of this clock.
Nard, his pass is dropped. Off the hands of Mark Hughes.
And watching Tuskegee with their pass offense reminds me of how those wishbone teams used to look in the early 80s. Whenever they got behind, they tried to throw back and throw, just didn't look good. There was
right.
No rhythm to it, no synchronicity within it. And they just seemed completely out of whack whenever they try and throw the football.
Well, we've seen that even, you know, at the major college football level. You look at a team like Georgia Tech,
yeah.
So good at running the option, but when they get behind, they tend to struggle because they got to throw to get back into the game, and that's not their strength.
But you see Fabian Washington, those guys, they improved as passers. They don't look as awkward as they used to.
Narn has plenty of time over the middle, and it is incomplete again. Good coverage that time. He wanted Wayne Williams.
And so often with the passing game, it's all about finding the open man. And I want you to see the crossing route that's going to come wide open here. And does the quarterback look for him? See, that separation. You deliver the ball to that guy right there, hit him in stride. He's going to run after catch and pick up the first down. Instead, throws an inaccurate ball to a wide receiver that was pretty well covered.
Line drive punt takes a bounce at around the 40, and it's going to be downed by Tuskegee at the 32-yard line, a 45-yard punt. Our Twitter question earlier was, what's the best rivalry in college football? And certainly, we expect to get a variety of answers. A lot of it depends on where you went to school, what geographical region you grew up in.
Give me one, Anish. What would you say?
Well, there's USC, Notre Dame. That's the USC's won 9 of the last 10 meetings. I mean, Ohio State, Michigan jumps to mind. I love Oklahoma, Oklahoma State, Bedlam.
Yeah.
If you saw that great 30 for 30 by ESPN Films, War Eagle, Roll Tide.
Oh, man, that was awesome.
And given what's happened over the last couple of years, how successful those two teams have been in their history, especially being in Alabama. And a fumble as Tuskegee has it. So second turnover by Alabama State.
Knee was on the ground. Second down.
Well, Landon Jones, they're saying his knee was on the ground, so it is not a fumble. Looked like the ball came loose. Let's take another look.
It looked like the ball came loose, and clearly his forward momentum had stopped. They've got him sandwiched.
Oh yeah, knees down. Yeah. Both knees are down. Empty backfield. Jenkins throws, that one too strong for Pete Adams, went right through his hands, third down. But going back to the rivalries, you know, Alabama-Auburn, the Iron Bowl, that has been closely contested over the years. And, of course, last year it looked like Alabama was going to win that game, and then Auburn makes that great comeback.
Cam Newton, that'll happen when you've got the Heisman Trophy winner playing quarterback for you.
Oregon, Oregon State, Civil War, it was Bedlam. Jenkins takes off, and he's going to be short of the first down. Isaiah Person, who is from Auburn, Alabama, making the tackle.
Good job by the Tuskegee defense to finally slow down this Alabama State offense to get a three and out here.
You've got Georgia, Georgia Tech. I mean, when your rivalry game is called clean, old-fashioned hate.
How about Clemson, South Carolina? That game has really started to magnify in recent years.
High punt. Tuskegee will let it bounce. It takes a Golden Tiger bounce. And Tuskegee will have it at about the 34-yard line, only a 24-yard punt. And we have reached the end of the first quarter, one dominated by Alabama State and its quarterback, Greg Jenkins. He threw for a score and ran for a score. Hornets up 17-0. Michigan State. Just moments ago, the 1991 Black College Football National Champion Alabama State team being honored down on the field.
That was a very special team. You see number 57 there. Our colleague Eddie Robinson played linebacker for him. Also, you see Coach Reggie Barlow going out there. He was a member of that team, shaking hands with his old teammates. That team went 11-0-1. Undefeated in SWAC play, but they were tied that year by Texas Southern University.
Alabama State at one point this year was the number one team in Black College football, and they lost to Alabama A&M in the Magic City Classic, lost their regular season conference finale to Southern, and missed a chance to play in the SWAC championship for a second consecutive year. Nard on first down completes. That's Pippen. It's only his second completion. Pippen, a couple of nice moves. And he gets to the 38-yard line, a gain of 6 yards.
And you talked about the Alabama State season. They were number one in Black College football, taking on Alabama A&M in the Magic City Classic. This PAT right here, I think, was a turning point. That block PAT was a turning point for their season. Had they made that PAT and won that game in overtime because they had all the momentum, they would have clinched the SWAC championship. But after that, they lost to A&M, beat Pine Bluff, and last week's loss to Southern ended their season, saying this will be the last game and they will not make it back to Birmingham.
Well, they had a chance. They needed Prairie View to beat Alabama A&M. That didn't happen. Alabama A&M won, and so Alabama A&M will represent the SWAC East in the conference championship. This is Nard. He's going to throw, and he completes. That's Larry Cobb on the catch, a gain of 14 yards.
Yes. Good job here. I want you to take a look at the outside linebacker here for Alabama State. Watch him do the recognition, come up, flow with the play, realize what's going on, turn, look, where's he going with the football, find the receiver in the second level, go and make the tackle. That's Donovan Massline playing that cornerback position. Good job there, recognition, but it was a good throw there by Nard. Maybe he can build some momentum off of it.
So Tuskegee with 20 yards already here in the second quarter. They had 9 the entire first quarter. Nard options to his left, and he's going to be spun down in the backfield by Edward Mosley.
and that's a mental error right there. Edward Mosey was a defensive end. If you're going to run that option play down the line, read the in man on the line of scrimmage. This is Mosey right here. This is who you do the pitch off of. As they go through with the play, once he's unblocked, you've got to pitch the ball. You've got a running back with the lead blocker out there. He holds on to it. Freshman mistake. Tackle for loss by Mosley.
What did Willie Slater refer to Nard as? Daggum freshman.
He said that about his old offensive line, the left side. Daggum freshman. You can't say daggum.
You got to borrow from the Bobby Bowden vocabulary. Nard on second down throws, and it is complete. That's Wayne Williams. He's their top receiver. And that's going to be a first down.
And Williams is the guy, he said, could be the playmaker, the special talent where if we do have to stretch the defense, that's who we go to. But you're talking about a guy that leads this team in receptions with 17 catches on the season.
That was his 18th catch. Do the math. This is their 10th game of the season. He leads the team with 18 catches. He leads the team, and he's averaging less than 2 catches per game.
That's not the Tuskegee Airmen.
No.
Off the Tuskegee ground.
This is Ryan Crespo. He's been a productive runner for them this season. Hasn't had a lot of carries, but 4 touchdowns will come in on short yarded situations. Averaging better than 5 yards a pop.
You can tell Tuskegee taking their time, getting to the line of scrimmage. They're in no hurry. Look at the quarterback comparison between the freshman and Greg Jenkins. Right now, Greg Jenkins clearly has the upper hand. He's playing at a high level. But Nard right now is putting together his best drive of the night.
He's completed 3 in a row. Another option. This is Pippen. And Pippen with a first down inside the 25 and a gain of 7 yards.
See, they went back to it and they called the same play to see if the freshman was going to learn from his mistake. Option play, in man on the line of scrimmage. He's in a pickle. Can't be right. Pitch the ball, gets it out to Pippen. They pick up positive yardage.
This is what Tuskegee needed, a drive where they can eat up some clock, keep that defense off the field.
And once they start having success running the football, now Alabama State's going to bring some pressure and crowd the line of scrimmage.
That was Crow, the fullback, on first down, and he gets 2. Second down and 8. Mosley again on the stop.
See, as a quarterback, when you see that look, you've got to have the confidence to say, we got to check out of this play. And if we cannot have 7 blockers taking on a 9-man box, that's when we've got to check out of it. But as a freshman, rarely do you have the confidence to second-guess your offensive coordinator or your head coach. But you got to realize the play that comes in from the sideline, that's just a recommendation. As a quarterback, you're responsible for the overall result.
Got to remember, though, Nard, again, a true freshman. Not even the benefit of a redshirt. The plan was to redshirt him, but he emerged as their best answer at the quarterback position throughout the course of the season. This is Pippen. And he gets close to the 15-yard line. It'll bring up 3rd and about 2.
And that was your first time seeing the belly right here. You're going to see both the guard come over there, number 72, pulling over there. Michael Thornton going from the right side to the left side. That's that belly G play that when things get really tight on Tuskegee and they really want to try and hammer a point home, look for the belly G with the pulling guards, either Michael Thornton or Darryl Whitfield on the other side.
When we talked to Willie Slater, he sounded surprised that the belly G was Tuskegee's trademark, but everyone else that we've talked to has said, yeah, that's what they're going to do, the belly G. And timeout Tuskegee, their second timeout of the first half. They're trying to get on the board for the first time. A big 3rd down for the Golden Tigers when we come back.
It's not for women.
It's been a good start for Reggie Barlow and Alabama State here in the Turkey Day Classic. Oldest rivalry in black college football. One that's been dominated, though, by Division II Tuskegee. They've won 12 of the last 15, including a 17-10 win last year against Alabama State when the Hornets went on to the SWAC championship and won the SWAC East. Big 3rd and 2 for the Golden Tigers here. Nard, don't run the option. Turns the corner, tries to stiff arm a man, and it looks like he got enough for the first down.
This was a design quarterback run all the way. A great job by the fullback. Watch him go out and seek and destroy somebody on the outside second level. Ryan Crespo, the fullback. He's looking. Follow me. Boom! That's that little hit that you needed in order to spring the quarterback free so they can pick up the first down.
Tenth play of the drive coming up. And it's Crespo, the fullback, getting it to the 5-yard line. Solid pickup there, 8 yards. So far and away, Tuskegee's best drive. It started back at their 33-yard line.
Yep, and it all got going when the freshman quarterback, Nard, was able to connect on a deep pass and then started to settle down, find his rhythm. And the offensive line starting to take control of the line of scrimmage, causing some mismatches.
Two tight ends, I formation. This is the power I set. We could see Belly G.
Yeah, you see they're calling a check right now to change direction because Alabama State knows that they've overloaded the right side, so look for them to run to the left.
And they do. It's Crespo spinning forward, and he appears to have the first down. If it's good enough, it'll be first and goal.
And that was really good recognition by the freshman quarterback, Justin Nard, realizing that Alabama State came with an over front, meaning they put more bodies on the right side than they could block. So he checked to a run play to the left side to try and attack the weakness of the defense. And sometimes that's just half the battle, putting yourself in a position where you have a chance at running a successful play.
And it appears Tuskegee has used another timeout. If it is a Tuskegee timeout, it would be their third and final timeout of the first half, but instead it's an official timeout. They're going to measure. That much. So Crespo's last run just shy of a first down.
Yeah, see, I want you to take a look. This is the center right here. So let's just draw a line right up the middle. How many white jerseys do you see over here? I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 jerseys on this side. That means that if you're going to run the football, they've got you schematically with the number count. Attack the other side where they're only three. Pull a guard. You've got a chance at having success compared to if you've got three linemen prepared to block 6 Alabama State Hornets, they can tackle you for a loss.
On third and short, I think the one thing we can all agree on, it won't be a pass.
It shouldn't be a pass. We've seen crazier things happen than these.
Crespo again. And appears he has the first down. He does. First and goal.
Not a lot of margin for error here, and this is just good old-fashioned football. Linebacker taking on fullback, and Crespo just had the will and determination to take on 2 Hornet defenders that were meeting him in the A-gap and able to pick up the first down. Fumble.
Nard lost it. Ball is loose. Did he fall on it? And Tuskegee will retain possession. So costly mistake on first and goal, but it doesn't bite him.
It's just a quarterback center exchange. Nard just seemed as if he never got an opportunity to catch that football. The center wasn't leaning, so anytime the center's not leaning forward and hits the quarterback hands, you got to blame it on the quarterback.
Fourteenth play of a drive that started back to 33. Nard will option again. Gets it to Pippen. He's got some room. He's in the end zone, and Tuskegee's on the board.
What a great job by Nard of really extending this option play, getting to the wait to the last second. Gets hit by 2 Hornets. makes the pitch to Pippen. But that was a great job by Nard of holding on to that football to the very end. And then DeMario Pippen giving up his body to get into the end zone.
So Tuskegee, a 14-play, 68-yard drive. They ate up more than 8 minutes of clock. And the Golden Tigers on the board here in the Turkey Day Classic.
Hey, where you been? Took my car again, huh?
Yes. Today.
ESPNU College Football is brought to you by the new Capital One Cash Card for people who want 50% more cash. Happy Thanksgiving. We're in Montgomery, Alabama at the Cramton Bowl, and certainly it is a day to pig out. Gluttony is allowed on this one Thursday. Tuskegee on the board, running the option to cap off a lengthy drive, and it's DeMario Pippen who gets in.
Yeah, take a look at number 12, Nigel Carr. He's got the pitch man right there, but he makes a decision to lose contain right here. Outside leverage there by Pippen. He gives up on the pitch man to hit the quarterback. Nobody there to stop DeMario Pippen from getting into the end zone. That's where you've got to play that assignment football. You got to leave your instincts out the door and just go ahead and say, hey, if I've got the pitch man, I've got to stay with them and let somebody else tackle the quarterback.
And what Willie Slater's got to like is his team ate up 8 minutes and 23 seconds. The Tuskegee defense was on the field for most of the first quarter. And he said the problem they've had this season is the defense has been getting tired later in games. Well, the way Alabama State likes to play with their pace, it was good to give that defense a little breather.
Yeah, maybe hope that the Alabama State offense can cool off a little bit after a hot start.
This is John Andrews. Using the stiff arm, he takes the defender down with him, but pushed out of bounds at the 30-yard line. So that's where the Hornets will start. Reggie Barlow was born in Tuskegee, grew up a fan of Tuskegee. Told us he would have played there except for one big if. They didn't offer him a scholarship. They didn't recruit him. So he went to Alabama State. I'd say all things worked out pretty well on his end.
I don't think he's complaining, and considering he went to high school here in Montgomery as well, I'm sure he probably would have been torn between the two, but when Tuskegee doesn't offer the scholarship, it makes your decision much easier.
Tim Clark looking for some room, and Tim Clark with a 20-yard run. He gets to midfield. The running back position has been a revolving door for Alabama State, but Tim Clark has really solidified that the last couple of games.
Yeah, between Tim Clark and Quindarius McKibben and Malcolm Cyrus, they've really gone with running back by committee.
Clark again, little stutter step, and he just gets back to the line of scrimmage, tackled by Isaiah Person. Talking to Fred Keiss last night, he said Clark will probably get about 80% of the carries. Quindarius McKibben won't play in this game for unspecified reasons. And Malcolm Cyrus, who's a true freshman, will serve as the backup in this game. Jenkins throws over the middle, and he completes. He has been on target all afternoon. And that's Nehemiah Henry on the catch. And there is Fred Keiss. And we should mention that Brenda Jordan, his sister, it's her birthday today, so we want to wish Brenda not just a happy birthday, but also a happy Thanksgiving. Intended for Henry again, incomplete.
Right now, this Tuskegee defense able to come up with another three-play stand. They can prevent the Hornets from getting a first down on the fourth down, which appears to be a punt conversion. Starting to change the momentum of this football game. Alabama State came out on fire. The pace and tempo was working. Now Tuskegee slowed down the tempo and starting to play their style of football.
Well, the last two drives, Alabama State hasn't taken as many chances downfield. They were successful doing that early. This one bounces at the 15, and it goes out of bounds at around the 18-yard line 29-yard punt, no return. Tuskegee, if they can score on this drive, they're right back in it. Enjoy football while you feast on this.
College football kicks off at noon Saturday on ESPNU.
Here's to the pursuit of better, faster, cleaner, funner. Here's to the pursuit of another 100 years of earning America's trust. Not just oil, Pennzoil.
How soon folks forget.
Yeah, remember with Jevin Snead, expectations
Jevin
really
Snead.
High.
I say Jake Locker, Jevin Snead.
Jevin Snead. He was supposed to be an NFL prospect, and his final year just did not work out. On the ground, that's Pippen, and he's to the 20, a gain of 2 yards on first down. Tuskegee, its last drive, a 14-play, 68-yard march that ate up more than 8 minutes. He can put another lengthy drive together. Would bode well for a defense that was on the field for most of the first quarter.
And I think more importantly, they really want to just eat up some clock. If you're not going to score, that's one thing, but don't give the ball back to Alabama State with more than 2 minutes left on the clock.
A little play action by Narn. He's going to step up, he'll tuck it and run. And a flag at the end of the play as Nard is taken down at the 23-yard line.
Personal foul, face mask. Number 40, defense, 15 yards, automatic, first down.
Well, it's going to come at the end of the run here by Justin Nard. You saw him pull the face mask right there when he was going towards the ground. Big penalty, and it gives the Golden Tigers a first down. 40-yard line, Brandon Slater, an outside linebacker.
Nard running the option, and Pippen slips in the backfield. No gain.
That was quick penetration brought by Keewon Riley from his safety position. We know he can go play pass defense very well, but you saw the cat-like quickness there to really get into the backfield in a hurry to force Pippen to lose his balance and slip off guard. I mean, you talk about a special talent, Keewon Riley. NFL scouts wish he were coming out of the draft this year, which is a decision he'll probably have to make, but the way he attacks the football and plays pass coverage, good speed, good body, good build, great football play.
Already an interception in this game for Riley. This is Nard, another option, and that one mistimed. It goes out of bounds. It'll be a loss. They only lose about a yard, so it'll bring up third and 11.
And they're continuing to run this option, so they've given up the belly G for the option. And if you're going to pitch the ball that late, it's got to be an accurate toss, and you must know where your pitch man is at all time. That time, by pitching the ball out of bounds, ended up losing a couple of yards.
Alabama State wants this. They want Tuskegee to throw the football. It plays into their strength, the secondary anchored by Riley, and Tuskegee's weakness. As a team, they're under 41%. In terms of completion on the season. Here's pressure. Nard in trouble, and he's brought down by Maslin. Donovan Maslin, the corner blitz, and fourth down coming up for the Golden Tigers.
You called it there. They brought Donovan Maslin coming from the right side. He's so far out, he's not even going to be in your screen when he comes up here. And he comes in late. They don't account for him. Nard doesn't see him coming. Maslin makes a good move underneath to get the sack.
Gene Moody to punt. Keewon Riley signals fair catch. Makes it at the 30-yard line, so Alabama State's defense holds. And it'll be Hornet ball with a 17-7 lead and 2:13 to go in the first half. Stay with us. Oh. 17-7, Alabama State leading Tuskegee with 2:13 to go here in the second quarter. It is the Turkey Day Classic. They danced well past midnight.
I like that term. Cinderella breaking curfew.
Jenkins throws. He's got McWilliams on the far side, but there is a flag.
Eligible receiver downfield, number 8, was covered up and went downfield on the pass, 5 yards.
That's Nick Andrews. You don't see that called on a wide receiver that often.
Yeah, that's one where the rule says you have to have at least 6 men on the line of scrimmage, and then you kind of find out where are they. So they've got 1, 2, plus the 5 linemen, plus another. So that's too many men. And once he comes on the line, these folks are ineligible.
Less than 2 minutes to go here in this first half, but Alabama State can score quickly. This is a run. It's Clark. He's got some room. Clark with a nice cutback, and he's into Tuskegee territory. 26 yards on the play. Strong running by the senior.
Good job there by Tim Clark, and in true Alabama State form, after the big run, don't think they're going to slow down. They're actually waiting for the change right now so they can snap the football. They've got their pedal to the metal trying to have up tempo.
Jenkins pumps, throws downfield, incomplete in the direction of Henry.
That was a good job by Nehemiah Henry there. The defensive back did not fall for the double move at all. He was in great position to make an interception, number 19, Kenneth Baker. And had Henry not gone up and played defense, could have been an interception.
Hornets still have all 3 timeouts. Jenkins will keep it. And he's tackled at the 45-yard line. A gain of 4 yards. Kevin Finizzi brought him down.
The offensive line for Alabama State, they've struggled at times, but the interior line play from Edmund Davis, the freshman, to go along with Jerron Bush, has been really good in opening up some good running lanes.
Again, getting the playoff with plenty of time on the clock. Tim Clark with a first down across the 35. It's Finizzi again with the tackle, but 11 more yards and with 3 timeouts, their 2-minute offense, they move so fast, they're able to run the football.
And the moment the change is set, you're not going to see a lot of time go off the clock before they snap the football. And maybe they realize they're in pretty much a scoring range. They can slow down the tempo a little bit.
Jenkins pumps under pressure and down he goes. Jeremy Brown, big number 95, got him, but there is a flag. And I think it might be a face mask on Brown, as Jenkins is hurt.
Personal foul, face mask, 95, defense, 15 yards, automatic, first down.
It is a face mask penalty, and Jenkins seems to be holding that wrist.
You see Jenkins kind of scan the field, but at the end of this, take a look and see what happens. He just kind of goes down, like when he did that pump with the football.
Looks like when he put his hand down, his hand went hard into the ground. Watch the hand.
See, I thought I saw when he actually grabbed that football with that pump that he felt the pain there and just realized something wasn't right. So take a look. Watch this pump. He's going to pump it when he's like, oh, something doesn't feel right. Takes that right hand off the ball immediately to protect it in defensive fashion. And just went to the ground.
Training staff working on that right hand. As good as Jenkins has been all season, keeping him healthy has been the big challenge for Alabama State. If he can't go, they do have an able backup, Devin Dominguez. He doesn't bring the running dimension that Jenkins does. He's more of a drop back guy, but he's a guy who's played in big spots. He started last season, played most of last year. So it's not like you're throwing a rookie into the fire.
And that's one of the strengths of the Alabama State Hornets is they do have a capable backup. Dominguez has started some very big games in his career, and he's getting an opportunity to play here in his last football game as a Hornet. To be 6'5", 200 pounds, he is that athletic, but just not as fast as Jenkins.
Dominguez will throw in his first play, and he finds Clark, who's got some room. Touchdown, Alabama State.
You're just going to see Clark come across the formation. They're going to forget about him at Tuskegee, and you won't get a throw any easier than this. He goes over to the right. They don't keep tabs of where Tim Clark is. Easy throw, easy catch, easy touchdown for the Hornets.
That's got to be a nice moment for Devin Dominguez, the redshirt senior from Fort Wayne, Indiana. Originally came to Alabama State on a baseball scholarship with a touchdown pass on senior day and homecoming. Wenzig's point after is no good. Yikes. That was hooked badly.
And when they don't account for the running back, they focus on Dominguez with the misdirection. The pocket's moving to the right. Clark does a good job of sneaking out of the backfield. Great play call by Fred Kice.
And that's also the confidence in a fifth-year senior quarterback. You can bring him into the game. You feel comfortable throwing on the first play with a new QB.
Right away, and that's the opportunity. You've got to seize the moment there. Dominguez knows, even though we're throwing the ball all the way across the field, if it's not there, because of his experience, he would know to tuck the football and run with it. What a great job by Devin Dominguez. A tremendous opportunity. You see his size there at 6'5", 201. You know, he doesn't have a frame to be as athletic as Greg Jenkins, but battle-tested, played some great games for him throughout his career. Started in the SWAC championship game for him a season ago.
Started in this game a season ago. Greg Jenkins, the starting quarterback, was playing so well too. 16 of 21. Squib kick here, takes a high bounce. Wayne Williams across the 35-yard line. Let's go back to the Jenkins injury.
You know, this is the one there. To me, it seems as if something within that pump fake when he had the ball, and by the time he tried to squeeze it, maybe he got a sensation going up that right side, but he was clearly protecting that thumb when he was going down to the ground. And you just hope that's something that's not too serious and he'll have an opportunity to possibly come back in this football game.
We will try to update you on his injury as soon as we get word from Alabama State Sports Information Department. Let's see if Tuskegee decides to take a chance here with 31 seconds. They only have one timeout left. And a flag.
False start. Offense. 72, 5 yards. Replay. First down.
Coming up at halftime, our panel of experts will talk about their favorite rivalries and what makes some of college football's best rivalries special. An SEC story documentary, plus a recap of the first half here at the Cramton Bowl. Alabama State scored 17 points in the first quarter. They have a 23-7 lead. 30 seconds to play in the half. Nard, he uses feet. Dives across the 40 to about the 42. Clock keeps on ticking. And we'll see if Tuskegee even elects to call another play. And they are in Hail Mary range here.
It would take a tremendous amount of arm strength to be able to throw that football at least 60 yards in the air to the end zone and with the quarterback dropping back.
Tuskegee won't even call play. We'll go into halftime with the score. Alabama State on homecoming and senior day with a 23-7 lead. When we come back, it's the experts talking about the great rivalries in college football.
Saturday on the U.
Halftime here in Montgomery, Alabama. Alabama State leading the Turkey Day Classic 23-7. Well, the play that changed college football is the next edition in the documentary series SEC Storied, and it premieres on December 1st at 11 p.m. on ESPNU. The film looks back at the creation and drama of the first SEC football championship game. That was in 1992, Alabama against Florida. Here's a preview.
Talking about this game for about 2 weeks now. About 2 weeks, man. Yeah. Can't wait to see you guys play now. We know this team. Load up. Play action. We know it, man. Let's be on it, man. Let's go out here and play fast. Play fast. Play smart.
Well, Alabama State did that in the first half. They have a 23-7 halftime lead against Tuskegee here in the Turkey Day Classic. The Hornets trying to win this rivalry game for the first time since 2008. Tuskegee has won six of the last seven meetings. The one negative for Alabama State late in that first half, their starting quarterback Greg Jenkins goes down with an apparent wrist injury, and we're not sure what his status is going to be going forward.
And it's a different offense when Greg Jenkins is not at the quarterback helm. Devin Dominguez is an effective backup, but you heard there from the locker room speech, Coach Reggie Barlow is all about speed, pace, and tempo. Jenkins has that faster gear than Devin Dominguez.
Yeah, Jenkins had a terrific first half, 16-21, threw a touchdown, ran for a touchdown. We don't know if he'll play in the second half, still waiting for word. Saturday's college football menu on ESPNU at noon Eastern. It's the first round of the FCS playoffs. James Madison against Eastern Kentucky. Vandy at Wake. That's the 3:30 game. The Commodores bowl eligible with a win. And Ole Miss taking on Mississippi State in the Egg Bowl. That's at 7 Eastern. Houston Nutt trying to leave the Rebels with a victory. The second half is next. Alabama State leading Tuskegee 23-7 at the break. You're watching ESPNU College Football presented by McDonald's. Happy Thanksgiving to you from Montgomery, Alabama. The Turkey Day Classic, the oldest rivalry in black college football. And right now, Alabama State with a 23-7 first half lead. Hornets quarterback Greg Jenkins done for the game. You see his right hand is in a sling. It's in a cast. And Jenkins had a terrific first half, 16-21, more than 200 yards of total offense, running the ball, throwing the football. It changes things now for Alabama State. Devin Dominguez, who's the backup, more of a dropback guy.
And the key is they know that now they cannot afford to allow Tuskegee to have those long, methodical drives. With Dominguez, the points won't come as fast as they do, so they have to hold on to the lead. That's the fortunate thing for the Hornets. And we talked about Dominguez being battle-tested, but you do have to change your playbook. You can't call as many quarterback draws and all the QB runs and the options on the line of scrimmage. Dominguez, your typical drop-back passer, but he does have the senior leadership that you like in your backup quarterback.
He is a fifth-year senior, but Greg Jenkins playing so well in that first half. Let's look at Alexis' playbook. 16-21, 167 yards through the air. Also at 57 running, threw for a touchdown, ran for a touchdown. He's a true dual threat. Are they going to miss him?
Yeah, he's all about speed, and more speed. He's very fast, very athletic. He's probably the best runner on this Alabama State team. And when you run that hard, unfortunately, the game of football, injuries occur, and you put your body at risk, and it caught up to Greg Jenkins.
Fred Keist, the offensive coordinator for Alabama State, told both you and I that you have to see Greg Jenkins at 100%. Coming into this game, Keist said Jenkins was at 100%. He had talked Jenkins up to you, I know, in the past on a couple occasions, and both times you saw him, he ended up getting hurt.
And the thing is, when he is healthy, he's a phenomenal football player.
We saw,
you saw that. You saw it there. He's very explosive. But the problem you have with those explosive quarterbacks is defenses realize that, and they just try and put as number many hits on as they can on the quarterback, and that's the downfall. This is going to be a very interesting game, and Tuskegee was absolutely flat in the first quarter. But once the second quarter started, they figured out how to get some drives going, and if they continue to do that, they can get back in this game.
So the fifth-year senior Devin Dominguez will now lead the Alabama State offense, but it'll be Tuskegee who gets the ball to start this second half as Alabama State will kick off. The Hornets do have the luxury of a 23-7 lead. What does Tuskegee need to do to get back into this game?
Right now, try and score with this initial drive, make the halftime adjustments. That way you can put some pressure on the Alabama State offense to try and score and maybe force them to leave their comfort zone, and that allowed Dominguez just to hand off the ball and eat up the clock.
Wayne Williams across the 20. Williams across the 35, bumped out of bounds as he crosses the 40. State Farm, get to a better state with State Farm. This is what both teams need to do to get to a better state.
The Tuskegee only had 6 first downs in the first half. They've got to increase that so they can keep their offense on the field and create more turnovers defensively. Alabama State, make the adjustment to Dominguez coming in there playing quarterback with your play selection. And also, let's put a stamp to the tremendous career of Nick Andrews that he's had at Alabama State. Find ways to get him the football and be a playmaker.
Alabama State scored the first 17 points of this game all in the first quarter. Tuskegee had a long drive that resulted in a touchdown, but then Alabama State able to score right before the end of the first half. Nard on first down, throws, completes to Michael Thornton, and a nice run after catch by Thornton. He's into Hornets territory.
Talked about some of the adjustments, and if you're going to try and put pressure on the young freshman quarterback, there's nothing better than a screen pass that'll eliminate that effective pass rush, and they do it there, and a good job. They got the hit on the quarterback, but he was able to pick up the first down.
This is not a passing offense. Tuskegee, as a team, under 41% throwing the football on the season. That's completion percentage. Nard, options, Pippen. Loses one defender in the backfield, and he may have gotten a yard. It'll bring up second down and 9.
Alabama State defensive coordinator Cedric Thornton made the adjustment. They had some difficulty defending the option in the first half. Assignments were blown. Well, Tuskegee goes to the well one time too many. Great assignment defense by the Hornets, able to minimize the gain by Pippen.
Tuskegee this year doesn't really have that bruising running back. Talking to their head coach, Willie Slater, he said, ideally, he'd love to have that 200-pound Mack truck in the backfield. Just doesn't have that luxury this year.
Yeah, it's hard to run that belly G without the belly or the mass that you need to really run effectively between the guards and the tackles.
Up the middle, this is Pippen. He finds a hole, and he's inside the 30. A first down for Tuskegee, so an impressive opening drive here in the second half for the Golden Tigers.
And one thing that Pippen does have is the explosiveness. Watch him accelerate as soon as he gets that ball. Gets those legs churning, high RPMs early. Good center of gravity, low to the ground, high speed.
We have news on Greg Jenkins. We'll get it to you following this play. First and 10. Nard options. It's Pippen again. And he's pushed out of bounds after a gain of 2 yards. Greg Jenkins, starting quarterback for Alabama State, left the game in the first half with an apparent hand injury. We've now learned that he suffered a broken hand. So out for the game with a broken hand. This is Alabama State's final game of the season, and you hope he can come back strong next year.
And he had the broken hand on a play prior to the one when he left, so he actually was out there with a broken hand and didn't realize that. That's tough. Last game of the season. That's what the offseason will be for.
Pippen to the 19-yard line. 4 more. It'll bring up third and short.
Alabama State thus far having a little bit of difficulty getting the Tuskegee offense to throw the football. We said one of the keys is force Tuskegee to throw the football. Well, after the screen pass by Nard completed on the first play of the second half, they've been able just to run the football, continue to eat up clock. Now here on 3rd and 2, you're not forcing the hand of Tuskegee. They can choose either to run or throw.
Williams in motion.
on third and two, right up the middle, Thornton, and he got a first down.
You know, and that's one thing about the offense for Tuskegee. You know, they are being stubborn right now. They're basically telling Alabama State, if we get third and 1 to 2 yards, we don't care how many guys you put around the line of scrimmage. We're going to send some guys in motion, and we're going to run the football. That's what we do. And it's got to be getting frustrating for Alabama State. You're going to start thinking they're going to take some unnecessary risk, and will Tuskegee be able to capitalize?
On the ground once more, it's Thornton, and he's carrying tacklers to about the 5-yard line. He's going to be close to another first down.
When you got the running game going, everybody gets involved. Watch the tight end right here in the line of scrimmage. He's going to get up in that gap in a hurry. They're going to pull a tight end, get up to the second level. Good seal block there. Miles Robinson. You don't see pulling tight ends too often in the college football world. But if you've got an uncovered lineman, it's his job to go up and make the block for the guy that's covered.
Second and inches. A first down means first and goal. They'll run the option. This is Wayne Williams. And that goes backwards, so a loss on the play. That was the receiver coming in motion. Looked like an option jet sweep sort of hybrid there. Didn't work, though.
Yeah, they had been setting up that play with the option, and this time they try to do it, but you've got two Alabama State Hornets right there. Defensive end Raymond Hindenburg, as well as Nigel Carr, who had a tremendous first half. They weren't fooled by it, able to make the tackle for
a loss.
They
just needed an inch.
Yeah, kind of questionable call there on something that's, when it backfires on you, can cost you yardage.
Tuskegee 2 for 6 on third down, 26% on the season.
You've got to throw the football here.
They'll run it. It's Joshua Crow, and he's short of the first down marker. So fourth down and a decision for Willie Slater. Field goal unit still on the sideline, so unless they call timeout to talk it over, it appears they're going to go for it now. They bring in some players from the bench, but it appears that they're going to go for it.
Well, I can tell you one thing. I don't care how many wide receivers they bring into the game. Alabama State is going to keep that box loaded. They're going to keep the number count to their advantage.
Play clock winding down. Play clock at 5. Alabama State crowding the line. They go for it. Up the middle, Thornton, and he is going to be short of the first down marker. Turnover on downs. Now, they were just 1 for 9 on fourth down on the season prior to that play. Knowing that Alabama State's down to its backup quarterback, why not take the points this early in the second half?
Take the points, make it a 13-point game. And having that faith in the running game, let them down there. And they've been crowding the line of scrimmage, something they should have known. Will those points come back and haunt them? We'll see. Plenty of football left to be played here in Montgomery.
My boyfriend and I were going on vacation, so I used my city thank you.
Alabama State leading Tuskegee 23-7. Earlier in the game, the 1991 Alabama State team was honored. They were the Black College Football National Champions that year, and a part of that team has made his way up into the press box, into her booth. Former Alabama State legend and linebacker Eddie Robinson. What do you remember most about that 91 season?
Well, I think we had a lot of good games, but the biggest one probably was beating Grambling State, of course, with the legendary Eddie Robinson. And we won that game in Detroit in the Silver Dome, and that clinched the SWAC championship for us.
The Turkey Day Classic, we've talked about its meaning, the special place it holds as a rivalry game in Black college football. You played in it. You played in it with Reggie Barlow,
right,
Alabama State's head coach. What did this game mean to you guys?
Well, it was a big game. The fans were really big into it. And being that this is the 88th game of the Turkey Day Classic, I mean, Tuskegee is only 45 minutes away from Alabama State. So even though they were a Division II school, it was always that emphasis of you need to beat Tuskegee.
Now, with the schools being so close to in proximity to each other, is this something where year-round you kind of hear the trash talk in anticipation of this game?
Yeah, they had some good guys. They had a quarterback, Maurice Hurst, and a wide receiver, Chris Holder, who played a couple years in the NFL. And so, I mean, we knew those guys. A lot of the players went to the same high schools, and they were always really competitive.
That's John Andrews with the catch near the 10-yard line. It'll bring up a third down here for Alabama State.
And talk about the job having your former teammate Reggie Barlow now being the head coach at Alabama State and the direction he's got the program going.
Well, it's been a pleasure to watch Reggie. Each year he gets a little better. And they had that dedication for Coach Markham yesterday. He really sounds like a head coach. And I think he's grown into the job, and he's really filling that leadership role, and the players are falling behind him. And each year they're getting a little bit better, and I think they definitely have some SWAC championships in store for him.
Well, they get a first down here. Nice catch by T.C. McWilliams. That keeps the drive alive, a first down. Reggie Barlow, we remember him in the NFL. Mostly he's a special teams guy, kick return, punt return. You saw him as a star wide receiver in the SWAC. What was he like as a player at the college level?
Well, Reggie was a redshirt freshman, so he was a crab when we were all seniors on that 91 team. But the biggest thing about Reggie, he used to kill us when we always would do our the skelly going against the young guys.
Tim Clark could not hold on, but they're saying it's incomplete, so it's not a fumble. It's an incomplete pass.
That reminded me of Eddie Robinson right here out there, pass thrown in the swing route. What do you do? What do you call that?
You got to put that Rydell right in the middle of the numbers. I mean, you got to take that shot when you get it. Tuskegee, you know, they have a history of great defensive backs at that program.
Talking about guys like Drayton Florence now currently playing in the NFL, they seem to always have one or two guys that are extra special talents.
This is Dominguez. Doesn't do it as well as Jenkins, but he picks up four. It'll bring up third down. Eddie, you mentioned the dedication you were at yesterday. Alabama State's going to have a $50 million new football stadium. It'll open next year. What's that going to mean for this program?
It's huge. I mean, they've been promising that stadium since I got on campus in 88, so we're ready for it. I mean, next year it should be ready for the Turkey Day Classic. That's going to be a huge deal from recruiting and, of course, a new football complex also. And I think, like they say, it's a great time to be a Hornet. The campus and the school is really moving in the right direction, and I really like the direction that Barlow is taking this Alabama State football team. Of course, they would love to be in that SWAC championship game, Jay, but we were a game short losing to the Southern Jaguars and Alabama A&M.
Well, there's sort of been talk that the new stadium, Alabama State, they run the Turkey Day Classic every year. If it moves on campus, it may mean a Turkey Day Classic without Tuskegee. What do you think the new stadium means for the future of this rivalry that we're seeing here today?
Well, you love tradition, and you would hope that we can continue to play Tuskegee. I mean, 88 years. I mean, the oldest historically black college classic, so that's a real big deal. But, you know, we'll just have to see how that works out going back and forth. And that's the bureaucrats. They work that out. I'm just a football player, you know.
That last catch just shy of the first down, so fourth and inches, a decision here for Reggie Barlow.
What do you do right now, Eddie? If you're the coach down there, you could talk to Coach Barlow. What do you
tell
him?
You're auditioning for defensive coordinator.
Well, I think you have to punt. I mean, in this situation, that part of the field, I mean, with the defense playing well right now, Sid Thornton has those guys playing well, I would probably punt.
What a defensive guy. See, that's spoken from a linebacker. See, every offensive player says, we've got to go for it.
Y'all want snaps.
And what was Reggie
y'all
Barlow?
Want
Reggie Barlow is a wide receiver. He's going for it. Or at least that appears to be the call. Might just be a ploy to throw the defense off sides.
Yeah, from a shotgun position, you really don't think they're going to go for it on fourth and inches if he's in the shotgun. Now, if he calls a play from underneath the center, then they may go for it.
And now a timeout by Alabama State, so they'll use their first here the second half. And maybe Reggie's taking your advice.
But absolutely.
If you look at the down and distance on the field, you got to think you're really putting a lot of pressure on your defense if you don't get the first down right here. And you've got the offense that you pretty much limited just to one drive all game long. Can't blame you. Now, let me ask you this. I know you pulled for the Hornets, but deep down inside, see, Barlow had a theme all year. He wanted his team to go out there and be the first undefeated, untied.
Jay always brings this up.
Alabama State championship football team. Now you're like that 1972 Dolphins team where every year they get that loss in conference play, you kind of pop the cork and say, we're still the men, big men in Montgomery, huh?
Well, you know, you're always rooting for your team. I mean, I want Reggie Barlow to win every football game. I'm a Hornet, true and true. I bleed black and gold, and I'm always pulling for these guys. I mean, it hurts. We talked to the players yesterday. When they don't win the game, it hurts just like I'm playing the football game. When they win, I celebrate with all of them. So hopefully they'll go undefeated next year starting with this game.
Fair catch, Wayne Williams, Alabama State, a 37-yard punt. Eddie Robinson, former Alabama State linebacker, a Hornet legend joining us here. We appreciate you taking out the time, Eddie.
Always. Happy Turkey Day to all the people at home.
And happy Thanksgiving to you.
Thank you.
Good to see you. Sorry about that Texas Southern tie back in 1991.
Spoken.
Jay just doesn't know how to let things go.
He has to get in the last word.
Always. 2 years I've been dealing with this. ESPNU College Football is brought to you by Lexus. It's time to engineer amazing. That's our crew. We're getting set before the game, a little pregame Thanksgiving meal, and they work so hard all year for
us. Look at them stuffing their face. Look at them getting the grub
on. Well, they deserve it. They deserve it. They have worked hard all season long, not just today. You can wave at us. 23-7. There it is. Alabama State leading Tuskegee. 6:35 to go in the third quarter. That's something that you and I, Jay, are thankful for.
Very thankful. They try their best to make us look good. Some of us are harder to make look good than others.
This is true. Tuskegee football, their defense has been much better after giving up 17 points in that opening quarter.
Yeah, they figured out how to contain the quarterback, whether it's been Dominguez or Jenkins. They're keeping them in the pocket, not allowing the Alabama State quarterback to hurt them with their legs.
A run on first down, and that's Pippen, who picks up 4, second down and 6 upcoming.
You know, when you talk about the Tuskegee offense and the problems that they've had, a team that likes to run the football first, but when you're running behind 2 true freshman offensive linemen, that's just tough. I don't care how big they are. There's a difference between high school strength and college strength. You know, 6'3", 310 pounds as a freshman becomes 6'3", 315 pounds of more muscle as a junior or senior. So they're going through their pains, but the line is starting to improve, and they're starting to feel more comfortable, and they'll be okay, but it's just tough for all the Tuskegee fans to take these losses. They're not used to seeing 4 or 5 lost seasons.
Nard throws. He's got Williams, goes down to get it, but Williams wrapped up immediately. Saeed Lee made the tackle.
And Nard's got to make a better throw there. As a quarterback, you've got to realize the most important thing you can do is throw an accurate pass. Give your wide receivers catchable balls. That's what they like. You throw a quick hitch and you put it on the ground, he's got to reach down to go get it. You end up costing yourself 2 or 3 yards. Instead of 3rd and 1, now you're looking at 3rd and 3 just because the quarterback did not give him a catchable ball.
Tuskegee 3 of 8 on 3rd down so far today. Nord, and that's incomplete. He wanted the tight end, Miles Robinson. And it'll be 4th down.
And this is where lack of comfort in the passing game is. Take a look here. You've got guys wide open. Watch this matchup and tell me how wide open does Brandon Moten come. See, once you see that guy's open, get the ball to him. They're bringing that corner blitz. You got to recognize the safety's back here for a reason. If you get him that ball in space, he's got an opportunity to make one man miss and possibly score a touchdown.
Alabama State coming after the punter there. Tuskegee gets it off. Keewon Riley nearly fumbled it. Somehow he holds on. That was a dangerous play by the junior. Alabama State, though, will live to tell about it. They'll have the football when we return.
College football kicks off at noon Saturday on ESPN.
Alabama State leading Tuskegee 23-7 with 4:45 to go here in the third quarter. And we take a look at Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. We hope you're having a wonderful Thanksgiving. Nick Andrews, senior day, his last game as an Alabama State Hornet. He's got a touchdown catch. One of 9 seniors will move on after the season. What a career he's had, the most decorated receiver in this program's history. Dominguez throws for Andrews. That one gets by him, and it's intercepted by Adam Lucas. Lucas runs it in for six.
Got the lead. Ball security comes at a premium. Dominguez rolling out to his right. Let's see if this ball should be caught by Andrews. It should. Andrews started to run before he caught the football. Went off his gloves and into the hands of Adam Lucas for the touchdown. And whoa, Nelly, things just got tight.
And now think of this. Had Tuskegee gone for the field goal earlier in this quarter, all of a sudden you're looking at a six-point game. Instead, it's still a two-possession game. A costly interception by Devin Dominguez. It was intended for number eight. It went to number eight, just the wrong number eight.
It went to the wrong number eight, and that's one where Nick Andrews just wishes he could have had that back, make the catch go down to the ground instead of trying to make the spectacular running catch there in that way. But if you're Dominguez, you did the right thing, went the right place with the football. Don't let that rattle you. But now all of a sudden things just got a little bit tighter, and ball security is at a premium now in this football contest.
This is a Tuskegee defense that's giving up less than 300 yards per game. It is a very good defense. Their defense has kept them in games most of the season. Offensively, they've struggled to score points. So when you get six from your defense, that becomes a game changer.
And the defense plays well for them because that's where they don't have to play any true freshmen. They've all got plenty of experience, particularly in the secondary. And with great inside linebacker play from Isaiah Person, if they can hang their hat and make this game come down to a battlefield position, Tuskegee's got a chance.
Andrews from inside his own 15 across the 30. And he's wrestled down at the 33-yard line, but there's a flag on the play. George McCullum is the head referee. He's in the white hat.
There are two fouls on the play. Offside, kicking team, blocking below the waist, receiving team, offset them, re-kick.
So we'll do it again. 23-14, Tuskegee trailing. They trailed 17-0 after the first quarter and have actually outscored Alabama State 14-6 since. And remember, the Hornets down to their backup quarterback, Devin Dominguez. He is a fifth-year senior. He started three games this season. He has played, but Greg Jenkins, who played so well in the first half, broke his hand late in the second quarter, out for the game. And we won't see him until next year.
Dominguez has been the quarterback of some highs and lows in Alabama State football during his career. Noted earlier, came here originally as a baseball player, then played football, got thrust into action a season ago, had success. Jenkins came in and replaced him as a quarterback, and Jenkins has been injured throughout the season. Dominguez had some high moments, had some low moments, but he's a more than capable backup quarterback.
Kick it again. This is Riley. And Riley stopped at the 23-yard line. Coverage of college football on ESPNU continues Saturday at noon Eastern. James Madison, Eastern Kentucky. It's the first round of the NCAA FCS Championship presented by Enterprise Rent-A-Car. College football on ESPNU this Saturday.
Playoff. Somebody say playoffs, college football. Got a little ring to it, like it makes a little bit of sense, doesn't it?
Well, I'll tell you what. If Arkansas beats LSU,
All pandemonium.
Sudden, all the proponents of a playoff are going to have a lot of ammunition at the FBS level. Tim Clark on first down just gets to the line of scrimmage, taken down by Isaiah Person.
Tuskegee, you know, they're kind of in the same situation as Alabama State. Alabama State plays in the SWAC championship. Tuskegee's Division II, but because they play this football game, they would never be eligible to play in the Division II playoffs.
Dominguez tackled for a loss of a yard. Adontavius Turner.
That play right there is the biggest difference between Dominguez and Jenkins at quarterback. Dominguez has athletic ability. He's not a slow quarterback. He's not stationary. But when he runs, not quite as natural, not as fast, doesn't have the ability to make defenders miss as Greg Jenkins does.
And notice how much slower this offense is moving. It used to be one play and then you're snapping the ball with 25 seconds. Already it looks like an extra 10 seconds or so just to get set on offense. And now a flag, movement up front. At 65, Edmund Davis, the redshirt freshman from right here in Montgomery, Alabama.
And probably for the first time in this football game since the opening kickoff, starting to have a little bit of energy and life over on the Tuskegee sideline and in the stands. They're starting to get into it. Momentum is completely shifted in this football game.
This is a big third down, third and 15. Dominguez steps up, throws to McWilliams, and he's taken out of bounds at the 25-yard line. Fourth down coming up. Alabama State has to punt. You mentioned the field position game. They have turned already.
The tide is starting to turn, and Alabama State needs to get one of these long drives down the field. If you're not going to have the quick strike offense, then at least keep your offense on the field. Tuskegee's figured out a way to slow them down, regardless of who the quarterback is for Alabama State right now.
Wayne Williams signals for a fair catch, drops the ball, and Tuskegee seems to have covered it up. 38-yard punt, Alabama State. Forced a punt, but Tuskegee will have the ball at the 38-yard line.
The muff punt, very fortunate he was able to fall on that football.
The championship game scenario in the SWAC, Alabama A&M, they have clinched the East Division, knocking off Prairie View A&M. And then in the West Division, down to Grambling and Arkansas Pine Bluff. Jeremy Williams now in at quarterback for Tuskegee. Hands it off to Crespo on first down, and Crespo got a couple for second down. And new quarterback in, Jeremy Williams, began the year as a starter. He's also a baseball player. 51.4, far and away the highest completion percentage by a Tuskegee quarterback this season. Remember, as a unit, they're under 41% coming into play.
And they were relying on him to carry the offense at the beginning of the year. He wasn't able to do so, and that's when Nard took over as a starting quarterback. But Nard hasn't been able to muster up much offense, so they made the change. Trying to see if maybe the experience that Jeremy Williams has may pay off in this game.
That's three more for Crespo. Yeah, and in between Williams and Nard, you had Terry Braddon, the Howard transfer. They gave him a shot. It didn't work out. And Nard's a true freshman. I think we tend to lose sight of that sometimes. And you're critical of his play. You have to remember that he's got a steep learning curve here. And he's also a Division II kid playing against an FCS school.
He is, and a lot of pressure. You know, Tuskegee's got a great following, one of the winningest football programs in Black college history. But this is their biggest game. This is their biggest stage. And he might have come in here and got real wide-eyed and just didn't handle the pressure so well.
Williams to throw for the first time. He's got Williams. Williams with a nice move, and he's inside the 45-yard line into Alabama State territory. The Golden Tigers on the march.
Yeah, I mean, this is just going to be your basic curl flat combination. You'll see the soft spot in the defense is going to be right here. They've got one guy running the wheel, another curl route, nice pocket, good throwing lane for Williams to deliver a strike.
If you watched the first quarter of this game,
we thought it was going to be a blowout.
You did. Williams options to Pippen. And Pippen gets to the 40-yard line, picking up two.
One thing about DeMario Pippen, he doesn't have the mass that you like, but he's got something that all good running backs have, and that's that ability to make the first guy miss. Nobody ever gets a clean shot on him. Very difficult to bring down in the open field.
Willie Slater called him a joy to coach. As we're coming up on the final seconds here of the third quarter, let's see if Tuskegee even elects to call a play. They do. Pippen up the middle. And he's to the 36-yard line, giving four more. We have played three quarters of the Cramton Bowl here in Montgomery. It is still anybody's game. Tuskegee driving, down just nine.
The battle
on ESPNU.
It's a nine-point game, start of the fourth quarter. 88th annual Turkey Day Classic. Alabama State leading the Hornets. Lost some momentum here when starting quarterback Greg Jenkins went down. He broke his wrist. So the 50-year senior Devin Dominguez came in. He did throw a touchdown on his first pass, but a costly pick here that got Tuskegee right back in this football game.
It was at a point in the game where you knew that the Tuskegee offense was having difficulty moving the football, so they decided to bring in a backup quarterback. That's how much the offense was struggling. The defense came up with the big play, and now the defense is feeding off of its energy. It's just a matter of whether or not the Tigers can jumpstart that offense. And they brought in junior backup quarterback Jeremy Williams, and he seems to have provided a spark for this offensive unit.
Reggie Barlow wants to win this game. It's the second year you and I have called this game, and I remember last year he was telling us, can't lose to Tuskegee. He said, as a player, he never lost in the Turkey Day Classic. You heard Eddie Robinson, who was in the booth with us a little while ago, former Alabama State linebacker. Never lost a Turkey Day Classic. And I'm sure that feeling is the same on the Tuskegee sideline. They've won six of the last seven. On third and four, Williams options to his left. He'll keep it. He's got a first down and a flag at the end of the play. Going to be holding against Tuskegee, so this will come back.
Offense, 6-9, 10 yards, was by the foul, replay, first down.
That's the right tackle, Charlie Craig. So now third and four will become much longer.
And at some point, even if your unit doesn't pick up the first down, if they get close, then if you take a look at the score and you're down by nine, is that when you possibly think about going for it? I think if you get, you know, if you can get it to fourth and less than two, you take that opportunity to go for it. And that's something you've got to tell your quarterback. You know, let Jeremy Williams know, hey, you got to hold on to the football, cannot afford a turnover here.
Well, they have a kicker in Eduardo Murillo who hit a 50-yarder, school record in his last game. That's why it was a little confusing. They didn't attempt a field goal earlier in the second half. It would have made it a 23-17 game right now. And another flag before the play. Looks like Craig jumped again.
With Murillo, he's 7 of 11 on the season, so not bad.
Third and long here for Tuskegee, and they've got to go to the air. Alabama State knows this. Keewon Riley, who's a ball hawk playing safety, already has one pick today. Now Alabama State, 22 interceptions on the season, 37 takeaways at second in the FCS. Williams has time, throws over the middle, finds his man in stride. Khalid Williams, and a huge first down. Tuskegee through the air.
Yeah, wow, what a great job by Williams of standing in the pocket. This is just going to be a good old-fashioned seam route. And watch where he connects with this ball. After he gets around the linebacker, looks for him, that ball's thrown perfectly. Not a lot of room for error. Huge third down conversion.
And there is a man down on the field back near midfield. It's 77, the right guard, Darrell Whitfield, the junior from Mobile, Alabama. And while we have a minute, we remind you college football continues Saturday with a pair of games. The All-State Game of the Week, 3:30 Eastern, Vandy and Wake Forest. Vandy bowl eligible with a win. And then at 7 Eastern, Ole Miss and Mississippi State, the Egg Bowl. That comes away at 7 Eastern. Houston Nutt, his last game as head coach of the Rebels, out at the end of the season. And Whitfield helped up, but he'll be helped off the field. Well, how about the end of that Vandy Tennessee game from last Saturday, where the officials got the call right, but then because they blew the whistle, which they shouldn't have, the right call ended up being wrong. It was a strange circumstance. If you didn't see the game, Vandy and Tennessee went to overtime. Vandy had the ball first. Jordan Rogers was intercepted. The Tennessee player ran it back for a touchdown. But initially, he was ruled down. They reviewed the play, said his knee was not down, went into the end zone, touchdown, game over, that's it. Well, after the game, it was then known that the official blew his whistle when he ruled the player down. So by rule, you blow the whistle, it's a dead ball. You can't challenge the play. At the end of the day, the right call ended up standing, but by blowing the whistle, which shouldn't have happened, that call should not have been made. Tough to follow. Jeremy Williams with a nice run there, gain of 10 yards on first down.
Wow, they're going to bring the two inside linebackers on the blitz. See, once they get this lane here and here, leaves the middle of the field wide open for the quarterback Williams to attack. See,
made that decision quick.
Made the decision quick because he realized they were vacating the middle of the field, and nobody ever accounts for the quarterback in the running game.
Pippen stopped right at the line of scrimmage, maybe got a yard. Carlton Jones leading the pursuit.
This has been a good job by Jeremy Williams, showing the leadership, effectively managing the offense. See, with 13 minutes to go, and you're down by 9, field goal is just fine if you can't get to the end zone. Don't take a chance on any careless throws. Make sure you know where you're going with the football. Do not chance an interception.
Four wide receivers. And it's a running play. Pippen bounces to the outside. DeMario Pippen into the end zone. Tuskegee right back into this game.
Great run by Pippen, but take a look on the left side of your screen. Larry Cobb, the wide receiver, is going to have the block that's really going to seal the deal and allow him. Right there, you see 83, engage with the defensive back. Once he makes that contact and locks him up, Pippen goes almost untouched into the end zone.
Point after is good. Second touchdown of the game by the senior, the Jackson State transfer, DeMario Pippen. No surprise, another close one in the Turkey Day Classic. Tuskegee right back into this game. It is 23-21. And where this game may have turned was when Greg Jenkins got injured for Alabama State, had been playing so well. Touchdown pass to Nick Andrews, runs it in for a score. and then watch this play right here. May have hurt his hand on this play. He would leave the game with a broken hand late in the second quarter. And now Devin Dominguez, the fifth-year senior on homecoming, on senior day, with a chance to go out as a hero for Alabama State and really own this moment.
This is what you want as a quarterback. Going into your last game, you don't think, I want to sit there and watch the game from the sidelines the whole game. You go to sleep that night prior to and you say, I hope I get the opportunity. You never wish injury on anybody, but you say, I hope I get the opportunity to play. Well, he's got an opportunity to not only play, but he can shine if he seizes the moment.
It's on Dominguez's shoulders to lead his team to victory. They have a two-point lead. And good special teams coverage by Tuskegee. Alabama State will start just inside its own 20-yard line.
You talk about the lead that Alabama has, Alabama State has, leading by two. That lead has been evaporating. They don't have that luxury of saying our defense can go and just shut down Tuskegee. Tuskegee has found a spark. So Dominguez is going to go out there and have to put some points on the board in order for his team to win.
So Devin Dominguez, he shouldn't be afraid of the stage. He started multiple times this season. In fact, he started Alabama State's last game against Southern. Jenkins came in late, nearly rallied Alabama State back. Dominguez was a starter for most of last season as well. A run here on first down. This is Clark. Clark's got some room, and he's into the second level, close to the 40. Finally brought down by Alan Singleton.
And that would be the biggest assist that you could give Devin Dominguez right now, is to establish the running game. Tim Clark at times showed some great flashes, had some big runs. If they can start to control the line of scrimmage and run the football effectively, that would really assist Devin Dominguez right now.
Eleven more for Clark, running strong here as we come up on 12 minutes to play in the fourth quarter.
Big number 70, Taron Jones, at 6 feet 7 inches tall, 320 pounds.
Dominguez throws it, nearly picked off. Darryl Simmons read it all the way, and Dominguez telegraphed that one.
When you start making throws like this, all the way across the field, wide side of the field, late outside, rule number one they teach you in quarterbacking. Can't throw the ball to the outside late, definitely not across the field. That will change the mindset of the offensive coordinator, Fred Keiss. You make throws like that, then you can expect for them to start running the football.
They go back to the ground and back to Clark. And falls backwards to the 47-yard line. Jeremy Brown in on the stop, and it'll bring up third down.
When they've had success running the football, it's been on the left side. Look at that. 6'7", 320 pounds playing left tackle. It's a grown man, Anish.
Third and five. Dominguez fires a strike over the middle to McWilliams. It's a first down.
Good job by Dominguez of really stepping into that throw. You said it was a strike, but I think he painted the outside corner. This was a fastball, ripped right through coverage, perfectly thrown. First down, Hornets. Look at the pocket. You see the protection there by Taron Jones. Nobody gets close. Accurate ball.
Here's Clark looking for some space. Ran into his own lineman and then pushes the pile forward. Let's see where they spot it. Clark down on the field, slow to get up. Emotions running high in this game. You got to remember, not only are these two teams geographically close, a lot of the players recruited by both teams, a lot of the players played high school football against each other, a lot of familiarity.
And in the grand scheme of things, Tuskegee has had more success on the football field than Alabama State in the past decade.
Dominguez rolls to his right, and he bounced toward in the direction of Nehemiah Henry. That was a ground ball. Dominguez, former baseball player. Two hopper.
You see Barlow, he's got that intense look on his face.
He's staring daggers.
And I think what I really like with Barlow instills in his team, he said, this game is somewhat bigger than you. It's not Alabama State versus Tuskegee. It's the SWAC taking on Division II Tuskegee in the SIAC.
Clark out of the backfield. Makes one man miss, and he's going to be very close to a first down. There is a flag at the end of the play.
Yeah, this has got to be on the offensive line. And while that ball was in the air, Tuskegee had sniffed out the screen call. And the Alabama State offensive lineman blocked the linebacker while the ball was in the air when he was coming up to make a play.
It is against Alabama State. Reggie Barlow not happy. He's watched his team build a 17-0 lead in the first quarter, and then he's seen Tuskegee.
Holy. Offense, 13, 10 yards from the previous spot. Replay, third down.
It's John Andrews called for holding, one of nine seniors on this team.
They're going to call it on the wide receiver. Watch the recognition. See, you see 33 comes up. He sees that. And right there, while the ball was in the air, 66, Jared Bush went and actually blocked him in the back. They called a holding downfield, which would be a spot foul.
Yeah, it didn't look like Andrews was in on the action, at least on that replay. But going back to the point, Alabama State, if you're just joining us, led 17-0 at the end of the first quarter. Their offense was moving briskly, in rhythm. Tuskegee has come all the way back to making a two-point game.
There is a correction on the penalty enforcement. There's holding, but the foul will be forced in the run 10 yards.
So that's that spot foul. It happened at the end of the run.
Somewhat of a break for Alabama State. So it'll be third and about 10 now. They have to get to the 23-yard line of Tuskegee. Nick Andrews, one of the best receivers of the FCS, lined up at the top of your screen. Dominguez rolls right. Andrews was calling for it, throws that way, and it's incomplete. Fourth down coming up, and now a decision for Reggie Barlow. You're looking at about a 50-yard kick here. Bobby Wenzig, the Arizona State transfer, one for one so far this game, hit from 29 in the first quarter. Long on the season is 48. And they will bring on Wenzig, who is also the punter.
And this is probably maximizing his range. This is going to be about a 50-yard field goal. Should be exactly 50.
It's a 50-yarder. He's had four kicks blocked this season. Kick is up, and it is no good. Alabama State with a missed opportunity to add on to a two-point lead. Reggie Barlow, not enough body language to will it through. ESPNU College Football presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. Jay, is that what you pulled up in, or did you show up to the game in that car?
That's an open car door with at least a 27-inch television in the door.
It's a nice ride.
Is he sitting on Dubs?
I wish.
Those are more like 24. As they say, not 24s, 24s.
Foles.
Who's winning this football game right now, Nish?
Well, the score says Alabama State.
But in the stadium, it says,
well, Tuskegee's got all the momentum. Down 17-0 at one point. They've cut it to a two-point game. And if Tuskegee loses this game by this margin, we can go back to a call by Willie Slater early in the second half. He had a chance to kick a field goal, decided to go for it on fourth and short, didn't get it. Jeremy Williams, quarterback draw. First down and more. He's close to midfield, down to the 47-yard line, 15 yards. Tuskegee playing with purpose.
Quarterback draw, watch the block by DeMario Pippen. He's the lead blocker, just go get in the way. Nice block in the secondary, and Jeremy Williams showing you some athleticism from a quarterback position as well. And Anish, I ask the question again. Who's winning this football game in this stadium right now?
Well, if it's a matchup between fans, Tuskegee's fans, they're into it. Alabama State, they've been quiet for a while. DeMario Pippen ran into his own man, and he's down after 5 yards. Brandon Slater credited for the tackle.
And it's crucial when you've got a game plan that's predicated upon running the football to do most of your damage. First down's important. If you can get more than 3 yards on first down, that's an effective play. It may not be as exciting as you'd like to see, but any coordinator would love taking second and five compared to second and 8, 9, 10 yards. Right now, Tuskegee's got momentum. They're rolling with their type of momentum.
98th meeting between these two schools, 83rd in the Turkey Day Classic. Tuskegee trying to win for a third straight year. And Williams lost the football.
And this is how you know things are going your way. When the ball's starting to bounce your way, this play was doomed from the start. The timing was not there from the snap, from the initial snap. From the ball snap, he misses it because he bobbles it on his hip. But watch him take the ball, run upfield, and actually pick up a couple of yards, and the ball goes out of bounds.
And he can't advance the ball on a fumble that goes out of bounds, so it's wherever Williams is marked down. That's where Tuskegee will have the football.
I thought he had picked up 1 or 2 yards before he actually fumbled that football, as if he had crossed the line of scrimmage.
Tuskegee 5 of 11 on third down. That's almost double their average coming into the game. They're just 26%. Williams options to Pippen. The stiff arm, and Pippen lunging for that first down marker appears to have it, but there is a flag at the 32-yard line.
That was a very late flag, and Reggie Barlow was on the sideline screaming for the holding call on the outside. It seemed as if the official that was closest to it didn't call it, but one of the back referees did.
Oh, offense, 82, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, replay, third down.
Well, that hurts, because now you go from a running down to a passing situation.
And you're going to see it right here. See, he's got him in position, but once the running back goes outside, he's got a hand on that jersey. You see the tug right there. The nearest official on the sideline didn't call it. See, the line judge didn't call it. But it's not his call, it's the back judge's call. They called the holding play. And that's the risk you run when you run sweeps to the outside. The officials can see it, it's right there in front of them. Easier to call a hold from there compared to in between the tackle box.
Four wide receivers. Plenty of time. Williams now going backwards, and he just has to get rid of it. Edward Mosley leading the pursuit for Alabama State.
But they did their job. They picked up a couple first downs. Now if the special teams can pin back this Alabama State Hornet return team, and maybe the Tuskegee defense can get a three and out. As we talked about before, the battlefield position game that this has turned into will play out before us.
Moody on to punt. Keewon Riley lets it bounce. He won't field it. You want to talk about field position. Alabama State's going to start inside its own 10-yard line after a 46-yard punt. Willie Slater, almost. And Reggie Barlow trying to get his team fired up. We have a great finish in store for you.
College football kicks off at noon Saturday on ESPNU. ESPNU is the home court of college hoops.
Open look. Hits the three.
Sunday at noon.
Visit fathead.com.
This is a big offensive series for Alabama State as they nurse a two-point lead, 23-21. Last play before we went to break, Tuskegee punting, Kenneth Baker. The ball wasn't close to the end zone. Had about four or five more yards to go. I don't know, maybe he saw too many of those Leon Lett plays that we've been showing on SportsCenter the last couple of days.
The ball was rolling towards the end zone, and they could have pinned them inside the five, probably on the 1 or 2 yard line. But Kenneth Baker lost track of where he was on the football field.
Clark from the 5 yard line picks up three on first down. El Malik Chin brings him down. Big series for Alabama State. They're scoreless in this second half. Their starting quarterback, Greg Jenkins, broke his hand late in the first half. And they really haven't been the same since Jenkins left the game. Clark brought down at the 9 yard line, picked up a yard, third down.
Alabama State's been using running back by committee, but I think they've established that Tim Clark is the man tonight. They've called his number often. He's responded to the call. The senior from St. Louis, Missouri, has had some big runs in this football game.
With Jay Walker and Ish Schroff, 98th meeting between Tuskegee and Alabama State. Clark again on third down, nowhere to go. And it's fourth down, a big hold for Tuskegee's defense.
And in the battlefield position, when you're backed up that deep, you got to think, I've got to gain at least 20 yards, two first downs.
What adjustment did Tuskegee make defensively since the first quarter?
I think they were able to go more basic when Jenkins left the game. That's been the big key. Even when Jenkins was there, they stopped letting the quarterback hurt them, and this is a beautiful punt.
Great punt by Wenzig. And he'll pin Tuskegee all the way back at the 21-yard line. That is a 66-yard bomb.
Wow.
Now, just what it looked like, field position would be pretty good for Tuskegee. Wenzig with a big punt. We remind you, Saturday, 3:30 Eastern, Vanderbilt. A chance to become bowl eligible. They take on Wake Forest. It's our all-state game of the week. And then at 7 Eastern, it's the Egg Bowl. Rivals Ole Miss and Mississippi State. One of many rivalries Thanksgiving weekend. Of course, here in the state of Alabama, they get Tuskegee and Alabama State, the Turkey Day Classic, and Alabama-Auburn, the Iron Bowl on Saturday. And Bobby Wenzig getting some love, the punter. That's a big punt in this game.
And I bet you 85% of the people on the sideline don't even know who Bobby Wenzig is.
Come on. A couple yards for DeMario Pippen. You were that guy. You were the quarterback who didn't say two words to the kicker, huh?
Only when you needed him. Only when you need them. Now, you had to bring everybody in. But I'm telling you.
I don't believe you.
There are some guys on his team who don't know who he is. A couple walk-ons probably haven't been around the program that long. But that was an MVP type. And that's one of those things that won't show up in the stat sheet in terms of winning the football game. But if they can hold on to the victory, that might have been the clincher right there.
Williams. Pippen hauls it in and somehow got a couple extra yards there.
I don't know if you'll see a better catch.
DeMario Pippen, second on the team in receptions, and he's a running back.
Yeah, I mean, watch him elevate in the focus. He only gets one hand on this football. I mean, ball's thrown very high. He got up and brought it in with one hand, kept the balance, and then picked up a couple yards. That's athleticism. Leap, one-handed catch in the air.
So third and five, Tuskegee. They're using their backup quarterback as well. Jeremy Williams in the game. The starter, Justin Nard, ineffective. Williams chased. Eludes the first defender, eludes the second man. And then he's finally brought down out of bounds by Brandon Slater, a loss of four.
See, they got away with the quarterback draw several times earlier, but this time nowhere to go. Great recognition by Drakeway Everett. He recognized him. Williams did a good job of keeping his balance, but there was simply nowhere to go.
Well, you want to talk about how field position can change. Well, now it's Tuskegee that'll be punting with their punter lined up inside his own 10-yard line. And Keewon Riley waiting at his 40-yard line, but a flag before the play.
False start. Offense. Number 23, 5 yards, replay, fourth down.
Another flag.
False start, 14. Offense, 5 yards, replay, fourth down.
So the penalties keep coming here for Tuskegee, and as the punter moves back, the return man continues to creep up. Riley now standing at midfield.
Keewon Riley is a very dangerous punt returner.
Moody's kick, fair catch signal, and Riley retreats inside his own 45 to bring it down. A 43-yard punt, zero on the return. Alabama State about 3.5 away from holding off Tuskegee here in the Turkey Day Classic.
Insurgents have had
fleeing to the countryside.
A high-speed person with been occupying.
It is a big week for rivalries tonight over on ESPN. Texas, Texas A&M. That might be the last time in a while those two play. The rivalry in that matchup, the future of that rivalry, I should say, very much up in the air. Arkansas and LSU, national title implications in Baton Rouge, and UCLA with a chance to play for the Pac-12 title. They got to get through USC first. Tim Clark finds a seam. Clark inside the 20, caught from behind by Kevin Finizzi.
Tim Clark has been the difference maker all afternoon. Great blocking up front in the trenches. Good job by Edmund Davis, the center, really sealing the middle of the field, allowing Clark to explode through the line of scrimmage.
Clark over 100 yards with that last carry, 137 yards. Now, also in a 17-yard touchdown catch.
Now look who decides to go to a little bit of a huddle type of offense. With holding on to a 2-point lead with 3 minutes to go, the up-tempo offense of the Alabama State Hornets decides time to milk this clock a little bit.
Tuskegee still has all three timeouts. Clark, and stopped right at the line of scrimmage.
And this is the time where I think if you're Tuskegee, you've got to utilize those timeouts and stop the clock. Don't allow Alabama State to huddle.
And Tuskegee has used its first timeout with 2:35, so they're hoping to hold at least Alabama State to a field goal here. Hey, Sunday on college, on ESPNU, we've got college basketball at noon Eastern. It is Tom Izzo and Michigan State visiting Eastern Michigan at 9:30 Eastern. Alabama, Jamichael Green taking on Virginia Commonwealth, the Final Four team a year ago. All part of Feast Week presented by Lowe's, Sunday on ESPNU at noon and 9:30 Eastern.
How big was that for VCU to keep Shaka Smart? I mean, he was the hottest name in coaching. Mentioned for several jobs and
yeah, deciding to stay.
That's one of those conferences in basketball that's kind of under the radar. The CAA, we talk about it in football, but
sure, Old Dominion had a terrific season last year.
George Mason. You know, that might have been like the original Cinderella of in the 2000s.
Alabama State, meanwhile, they've lost 12 of the last 15 Turkey Day Classics, haven't won one since 2008. 2 minutes and 41 seconds away from knocking off Tuskegee. They have a two-point lead at second down and nine. The Golden Tigers of Tuskegee use their first timeout, still have two left.
The Alabama State, you've got to continue to run the football.
This is John Andrews, the Jets sweep. Andrews! And he appears to have another first down.
I like the
football. That is a big first down, and that's Nick Andrews' older brother, another senior.
I like this call compared to throwing the football where you get the incompletion and you stop the clock. Jet sweep can pick up positive yardage. You get a wide receiver running at full speed across the formation. Find one crease, you can hit them hard for a nice gain, and they picked it up there. And now you put Tuskegee back on their heels again, having to look at clock management and determine when to call a timeout.
Yeah, Tuskegee not using a timeout here. First and goal. And movement up front, or it is a timeout. This one called by Alabama State, their second of the second half. And we take a minute to remind you, the FCS playoffs.
Playoffs?
Yeah, get started. First round, noon on Saturday on ESPN.
Be a little nugget on the FCS. If you take a look at the past champions, and you see James Madison won it all in 2004, the Dukes. James Madison had one win over a team that had a 500 or above record. Eastern Kentucky, on the flip side, one of the few teams in the FCS playoff field this year that got in that lost to three FCS schools. 7-4 record, they lost to three teams at the FCS level. So that matchup there is going to be kind of interesting. Call that one of those bubble matchups. Should make for a fantastic football game.
I know you were on that FCS preview show that we did at ESPNU. Who do you like? Who's playing well? Who in your eyes do you think has a really good chance of winning it all?
I think the sleeper team is going to be Central Arkansas. I mean, Sam Houston stayed undefeated on the regular season, number one overall seed. They'll be at home. They're going to be very tough to beat.
First and goal. This is Clark using the stiff arm. Just short of the end zone, but he's close. Picks up five. You seen Central Arkansas's home field?
Purple and gray. I thought my television was broken. But
interesting color scheme. Taking what Boise and Eastern Washington did to another level.
To another level. They just went with one color. They've got two. I wonder at some point would the NCAA come in and kind of regulate the color of football field. I
mean, it looks like a xylophone, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's like, you know, what point does it become too much of a distraction?
Well, here, Alabama State, they're on the doorstep. They can smell it. 23-21, Tuskegee not using its second timeout. And now some of the Hornets players trying to fire up the crowd as they'll reset the play clock to 25. .122 left. Alabama State build a 17-point lead at the end of the first quarter, led 23-7 at the half, and they've been holding on to that lead ever since. This is Clark into the end zone, and Alabama State is going to win the Turkey Day Classic. Although, and I know what you're thinking, 8-point game, and Alabama State did miss an extra point earlier in the game.
They did miss a crucial, and they had one blocked against Alabama A&M when they were on their way to clinching a possible berth in the SWAC championship.
This one, though, splits the uprights. Actually goes out of the stadium, onto the streets. Fans got themselves a souvenir, 30-21. And now Tuskegee needs two scores in 80 seconds. Close to impossible. But there is a flag. And Greg Jenkins went down with a broken head. Tim Clark really stepped up. And that's Terran Jones, the junior. Missed the early part of the season. Limping off the field.
On the foul, on the play, personal foul, 95, Tuskegee. 15 yards, will enforce on the kickoff.
That's Jeremy Brown. We call that a frustration foul.
Definitely a frustration foul. When you're down by nine, now it's the battlefield position. You still got to think, if we score, we can always go for the onside kick and maybe kick a field goal to win it. But now, really putting your offense in a bind.
That yeah, I've ever said, you might be able to just kick it straight through.
And at the turning moment, that 66-yard punt by Bobby Wenzig, when they were backed up over the head of the return man for Tuskegee, really allowed them to win the battlefield position.
And what that last penalty does, it allows Alabama State to kick off from its own 45. So now you can just put it out of the end zone and say, you want to go 80 yards in 80 seconds, go for it. And it still won't be enough. And Wenzig, you know, he's got a strong leg. Boots it into and out of the end zone. So Tuskegee ball with 1:20 to go, down by two scores. Devin Dominguez, the fifth-year senior, wasn't supposed to play unless the game got out of hand or if the starting quarterback got hurt. Well, Greg Jenkins, the starter, broke his hand in the first half. Dominguez, on his first throw, hits Tim Clark for a 17-yard touchdown, but then threw a costly pick in the third quarter that Tuskegee ran back for a touchdown. Alabama State is
behind with 12, five-yard penalty.
And now the frustration foul is really starting to mount on Tuskegee. But Dominguez, listen, he held his team together, didn't give up the lead, and Alabama State about to get its first win in the oldest rivalry in black college football since 2008. They lost six of the past seven, two straight, 12 of the last 15. That's going to be a catch. Larry Cobb, gain of 9 yards, clock still ticking.
That's the good thing going for Tuskegee, is the offense did come in and find a little bit of a spark behind Jeremy Williams. Passing game much more fluid when he was in the football contest compared to when he wasn't.
Williams over the middle, completes, and spun down is Mark Hughes. Gain of 20 yards. Clock momentarily stopped.
You got to be thinking quick strike. Now you're close enough, you got to take some shots down the field. You got the 2-minute offensive drive working. Go ahead and take a couple deep shots.
There's a deep shot. And over the head of Wayne Williams. Well, here's the thought. I call this the video game strategy, if you will. If you get in a field goal range, you kick a field goal, try to get three, then do the onside kick. Because you need two scores either way.
And that's been debated many times before.
Does it work in real life?
You're not playing, you want me to tell my age, you're not playing Tecmo Bowl.
Well, you look at the situation. 32 seconds left, you need nine. Does it matter the order that you get it in?
No, I think down and distance determines that, though. You get your face fourth down, then you go ahead and try it. They got to make sure they can figure out a way to cross midfield to at least keep the drive alive.
Another whistle.
Offense, 16, 5 yards, replay, first down, second down.
That's the wide receiver, Mark Hughes. You get the idea, Tuskegee losing a little focus here.
You can tell, and that, and also, you know, this is a team that came in not relying on the pass. They fell behind early, were forced to rely on the pass more than they would have, so they're just out of their comfort zone right now.
Williams fumbles the snap, and then he's sacked. Carlton Jones, a loss of 7. And a timeout. Tuskegee.
Good call by defensive coordinator Cedric Thornton. You got a team that you know is going to throw the football. Don't go to the prevent defense. Apply some pressure. Put them away. and solidify the win.
Reggie Barlow and his Hornets, they had a chance to win the SWAC East Division for the second straight year, but lost their final regular season conference game to Southern. Alabama A&M, we saw them earlier this year, looked very good against Texas Southern. You saw them in the Magic City Classic. They win the East Division. Grambling Southern on Saturday. If Grambling wins, they win the West Division. If they lose, Arkansas Pine Bluff would win the West Division.
What do the Washington Redskins Super Bowl teams have to do with that graphic?
Well, Alabama A&M's head coach played on one of those Super Bowl teams. So did Gramblings, and so did Arkansas Pine Bluff.
Yeah.
Monty Coleman, Doug Williams, and who am I missing?
Anthony Jones.
Anthony Jones at Alabama A&M. Yeah. Anthony Jones was Doug Williams' roommate the night before he was Super Bowl MVP, as Reggie Barlow gets the Gatorade bath. And he had never lost to Tuskegee as a player, never lost the Turkey Day Classic. That has to feel good, getting a win against the Golden Tigers, first time since 08.
The Bayou class is going to be special. Talk about the job Anthony Jones did for one. 0-2, they started off the year. He finished up 8-3. He's a finalist for the Eddie Robinson Award for the Coach of the Year. Been rewarded with his work. And Doug Williams taking over Grambling, stumbled out the blocks, made some change at the quarterback position. They've got a chance to win it all. They can beat their rival.
Foul. Defense. Hitting the quarterback out of bounds. 15-yard. It'll run. Automatic. First down.
Well, Reggie Barlow is a guy, when we talked to him before last year's game here, he admitted to us that there was some pressure on him to have a winning season, to get the program turned around. His first 3 years, he didn't have a winning season. And then last year, they get to the SWAC championship game. And really a hard-fought, gritty game. They lose to Texas Southern. At one point this year, they were the number one team in black college football. You know, if Greg Jenkins had been healthy, you would have to think there's a good chance that Alabama State would be playing in the SWAC championship.
I mean, thinking so and seeing what we see from the offensive unit, but now you can put all that stuff to bed, scratch it off the list. Reggie Barlow is now officially beating Tuskegee here in the Turkey Day Classic.
Reggie Barlow fired up. Alabama State knocking off Tuskegee 30-21. There's a Super Bowl champion. Former Jaguars wide receiver, head coach at his alma mater. He's got a reason to celebrate. Alabama State wins its season finale. 30-21, your final score. We'll wrap things up.
My sister's new boy.
With Jay Walker and Ishraf, time for the Lexus HBCU post-game report. Your final score from Montgomery. Alabama State 30, Tuskegee 21. The Hornets win the Turkey Day Classic for the first time since 2008. Tim Clark, terrific game on the ground, 168 yards of total offense, or I should say on the ground, two rushing touchdowns. And Alabama State hanging on after leading 17-0 in the first quarter. And joining us down on the field, head coach for the Alabama State Hornets, Reggie Barlow. Coach, I remember you telling us before this game last year what this rivalry means to you, what beating Tuskegee means to you. To get it done and to get Alabama State back in the win column in this game, what did it mean to you today?
Well, that's huge. You know, I grew up here in this city and coming to this game, and it means a lot to both universities and alumni. So we knew it would be a big game. You know, our guys came out and fought hard in the first half, and we told them that, you know, in the second half, Tuskegee was going to fight back, and they did it. They made a game out of it, but we were able to pull it out.
You guys had a moment there when Greg Jenkins goes down. He breaks his hand. You know you wouldn't have him going forward. What allowed the team to bend but not break?
Well, you know, Greg is our leader. You know, he's an outstanding player. It's unfortunate he got hurt. But we relied on Tim Clark, you know, running back. And Devin Dominguez stepped in and kept it solid for us. But, you know, these guys have been fighting all year. They've had guys to step up and make plays for us. And we're just happy to have really good players and that can step up and make plays for us.
Coach, this is your final game in the 2011 season. It's been a roller coaster ride. At one point, you were the number one ranked team in all of black college football.
What are you going to take back and reflect on when you think about this season?
Well, you know, it was a solid season. Of course, we would like to have played for the championship. It didn't happen, but we have some amazing seniors. We got 9 seniors on this team that they've been here the duration, you know, through the ups and downs early on in the program, and they stuck with us. So I'm just happy and proud that we can send them out 8-3. Winning season, and you know, I'm just proud for those guys.
Well, it is Thanksgiving here in Montgomery. Is your turkey going to be baked or fried?
Fried. Come on, man. In Alabama.
Coach, before we let you go, we know next year you guys move into your brand new facility. There's been talk about the future of this rivalry. It's produced some good games. Your gut feeling, are we going to see Alabama State Tuskegee in the Turkey Day Classic again?
Well, you know, I hope so. Like I said, I grew up coming to this game as a young kid, and it's always been special and one of my favorite games. And, you know, I just hope that we can find a way to keep it going. You know, of course, our administration has some really big ideas and want us to move forward, and we're looking forward to that as well. But I really enjoy this game.
All right, Coach, we appreciate your time. Congratulations on the victory, and happy Thanksgiving.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
So, once again, Alabama State knocking off Tuskegee 30-21. For an Alabama State team, we talked to Reggie Barlow, you mentioned it. I mean, they had aspirations at one time of a SWAC championship. This is a nice way to end the season, winning a rivalry game, doing it against a team that I know Reggie Barlow grew up rooting for, was recruited by. There is a little personal element here.
He did a good job of getting his team up and ready to play the Tuskegee Tigers. I mean, they had really nothing to play for except for their pride. They came out, they were clicking on all cylinders. And the future looks bright for them, but unfortunately for them, their future all hinges on the play of Greg Jenkins. They've got to keep him healthy.
That's the Lexus HBCU postgame report. Once again, our final score from the Cramton Bowl. Alabama State 30, Tuskegee 21. For Jay Walker, I'm Ivan Schroff. For our entire ESPN crew, happy Thanksgiving. Now let's get you to film room.